Adding an extra 5 hours of driving in.
Yeah.
So, how you doing? Thanks for your response.
Yeah. It, you were right. Yeah, that's where we are.
Thanks, yeah. Just wanted you to know that's what I said for that.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Well, we've had, that's, I don't know, probably, I mean, we've had some of those discussions. Where is the address?
We're not on CRP that we can build that capacity for.
Right.
Doing all the same things CRP does, but you know, more geared towards wildlife.
Right.
Safe acres is one.
So yeah, it was just really fun to spend 4 days, you know, with an organization that's rapidly growing and rapidly expanding, meeting all these bright young people. You know, for every job they have, they get like 100 to 150 applicants. So for every person who's in that room,
looking a little more at ease.
And they've stolen a couple people from us.
Oh, yeah.
Around and stuff.
What are we
going to
do?
So it's a small people.
What are we going to do with our season?
Yeah. State fish and wildlife.
You know, I'm debating.
I can, we'll tee that up here in a minute. And Ryan Wayne, so I made an attempt to translate the discussion from our last meeting into the questions I sent out in the focus memo the other day, and that's right here. This is a live board here.
Okay.
We can write on this board, on this wall. So I made an attempt to translate things out.
I think that's coming.
Yeah. I talked about yesterday's plans here.
Did you clear that?
Nice.
My whole world in August changes.
So you're at the West Basin?
No, I'm actually over at Chinook.
Oh,
I'm actually at Chinook. One-third cost. Port Astoria. I gave up on Port Astoria. It's impossible.
And you have to pay for a whole year there now, Astoria.
I had to pay for a whole year.
Should have stayed away.
But it's one-third of cost.
We're still looking for the Wi-Fi.
This is not a Wi-Fi.
People 6 days a week for 6 weeks.
Yeah.
Oh, wow, right here.
Oh,
right here.
Okay.
I don't think you're doing this.
I go postal.
Exactly.
No, absolutely not. So I got the same slip I've had for a few years. But what I do is I invite conservation partners in from all over the country and some around the world. And I just take the mission for 2 days of the crap on going.
Yeah. I talked to John Brown and I met John last year, right? I think right after I recommended him.
Yeah, John's Rock Hill, Pam, Cranberry, Hannibal Bolton.
Oh,
yeah. We just had a ball. We whacked
on
this
deck.
Yeah, it was really good fishing.
Well, hey,
my whole life will change for the next 6 weeks.
Absolutely.
What about your meetings?
Oh, and I didn't
what about your meetings?
This is a live.
Well,
so
I prioritized our customers'
meetings.
No fish.
And I built my. You can I built my schedule. All those other days
for coming in late, right?
Hi, Grant. How are you?
Chip. Yeah. Hey, Roger. Restroom is.
Out the door.
In the hallway by the open. There's a key on the. Coke rack right there.
Okay. Yeah. Do you need to go anybody else besides Mike?
Oh, it was locked, right?
Jim.
What?
He said it was locked, right?
Yeah. But let's not have to get back in this room.
I thought
you didn't have to beat your way in.
Oh.
check with me.
Ed, how are you?
I'm good, Jim. Living the dream.
Well, the next 6 weeks, I kind of put my biologist half of my brain on hold, and I turned my predator half of my brain on. I'm doing a guide salmon fishing with Greene for 6 weeks.
Oh, my goodness.
6 days a week.
Oh, my gosh.
Gives me an appreciation for what a guy's life is like.
That'll do it to you.
And I tell you what, I make a lot of political friends for salmon in the back of that boat.
Yeah.
And I'm real strategic about who I invite. I've got room for three anglers, so I really think about who I invite. And then I got stuck with one another for 3 days, for 2 days. And we're having dinners together and drinking at night and, you know, creating relationships. It's one of those strategic conservation things. I use my fish and my boat as bait.
Right. Little do they know. They think they're the ones doing the fish.
Give a little indoctrination. Salmon need help.
Great for me.
It's kind of like what they did up at the last week before last day up in Summer Shore. They just anchor my boat up all along the middle, didn't move for 5 days. And had people come in and fish me, and I'd sleep on the boat. And cook all my meals in the boat, and
oh,
the next day I drop off anchor and go to the other.
You're just like, well, what, just like one of those Portland boat people that just live in the river.
Do I have that number?
I've got the number.
I was the only boat up there.
Yeah, I don't see
a storm came yet. Oh my God, it was really haunting. My boat was bouncing around. The top started leaking. Oh my goodness, I had forgotten about this part.
Thank you. But the bite wasn't bad, was it?
No, we did fine. We got fish every day. Got multiple take bombs every day and got fish every day. And to release, you know, quite a few.
So that's what I'm getting. So Brad will be here in 5 minutes.
Are you sneaky when I know?
Jim Owens.
When you hear the tone, you will be the first person to join the meeting. The line will be silent until another person joins.
You can't even inside. Your house just smells like tuna for a time. Because we used to get 400 pounds a year.
It is definitely possible to have too much fun fishing.
And we can't.
You get lost, and then all of a sudden you look around and
you're going to clean all these. It's the same with bottom fishing. You get into a little bit of a few things, you mix it in.
Yeah.
Oh, God, it's only good.
That's true.
Who's there?
That's true.
Oh,
is
this
yeah. Okay. All right. We'll get going. Good morning.
Yeah.
Anybody, I hope nobody had too much trouble finding the place. Okay.
I did the great circle route.
All right. And grab me for parking reimbursement afterwards. So Lynette reminds us that this is a public meeting, so, and she's going to film this, so that you know.
Nanette.
Sorry. And we sent out a variety of materials for today. We sent out the tabs from the department's response to task force request about tiers of funding. So I pulled out for you the tab related to conservation opportunities, and there are copies of that. I also made copies of the updated work group guidance that sent out just a couple days ago, proposing an approach to organizing our conversation as we go forward. And I also copied the former guidance, where there's some specific questions in the task force. So those are all the materials.
Thank you.
Brett will be here in a moment. So the other group met just a couple days ago, Monday. And they're going to meet again next week in a short meeting. And from what I was there for part of the meeting, but not the whole meeting. Brett facilitated it. My understanding is they made some good progress. They kind of want to spend a little time translating it out and defining what their next steps are. And then they'll use a meeting that's scheduled for the 27th of this month. The next chunk of time that they spend together. So keep in mind, after today, we are scheduled for the 27th for this work group to meet again. If we need to meet between now and then, we'll make that decision at the end of today. So, first things first. So, we actually made a lot of progress in the very short time we had at the task force meeting. And I sent you out the raw notes from all of that. So I've made an attempt to try to organize that input based upon these focus questions that we had. And that's what's up on the board here. This is a live board in the sense we can write on this wall and it erases. So.
I thought it was that wall.
You do that wall. You'll be here for a while cleaning it. So why don't you take a couple seconds to look through this and digest it, and then let's check and make sure that this adequately covers the conversation.
Communication of the strategy fit into this? Is it under one or?
Well, what we have, if you might recall, in the initial guidance, we laid out those four areas of responsibility for the department. Mm-hmm. And in the conversation, you all said there's actually a fifth. And that's communications, mm-hmm. and that ought to be there in the function, list of functions. My recollection is that's about as far as we took that conversation at that point. Is that right?
I think so, yeah.
Well, in terms of the positions that we outlined, where we placed that responsibility and the response we gave to the task force, that was in the communicating or connecting with the outdoors.
Okay. So it's the
falls in there. Although Kevin and I were both at the outreach meeting the other day, and there is a lot of overlap between the two, because some of the outreach will be done by staff that could be brought on to do some of the biology or some of the work. So there is gonna be a lot of overlap between those two functions.
Sorry for the disturbance. I was up at the Oregon Community Foundation where our last meeting was, and then realized, oh, this is not Jim's office.
Were you able to get in the building?
Yeah. What are we good? Oh, you mean OCF or this building?
Oh, you went to OCF.
Yeah. That was my mistake. I was just migrating based on the force of.
So we were taking a look at my attempt to take the conversation from our last meeting and categorize it in those tasks we gave to the workers.
And it may be implied or encompassed in there somewhere, but another function there is the, sort of the maintenance and updating of the conservation strategy. And everybody, like this last time around, the department found itself embarking on a 10-year update with no funding to do that. Trying to patch things together in-house there with very limited resources. And particularly now, it's great, I don't know if you got a chance to look at the strategy online, the link I think you included in there, I showed you some the other day. And it's a position to be much more adaptable, living document, all electronic. So we now have at least the format, the base to actually update it as we learn new things, but we need some resources to be able to do that as well.
So that would be an additional funding objective to make sure the department is adequately funded to do that.
Yeah, and you know, I think probably if you get those other things, maybe that's there, but I just don't want that function to be lost.
So Jim, I always had a challenge understanding how the numbers are laid out. So I'm looking at this $47 million at the top, and then I'm looking at the $76 million at the overall bottom line. And my interpretation, these are biennial numbers, my interpretation is the $47 million is what's necessary just to do the science job. Is that what that number is? Compared to this, it's all three components.
Well, good we have Roger and Kurt here. So that was my understanding that this was the number for full implementation of conservation opportunities.
$47 million was the number that we came up with in terms of conservation opportunities. I wouldn't characterize it as full implementation of the conservation strategy, but fuller implementation of conservation.
So that's kind of the core science part of this. And then the $76 million adds on communication, branding, and outreach and other stuff.
Right, and the and the steps that are taken to reduce fees by shipping programs to alternative funding.
Okay.
And if you recall, the total number that was lined out was 85 by $6 million, including the deferred maintenance
number.
That's always going to be a challenge to keep in mind when we're talking about annual numbers, and what we're talking about, the core science or the other components.
So all the numbers we presented have been biennial numbers. So that's what we budget.
So what I heard in a nutshell in our prior conversation was that implementing the conservation strategy and the nearshore strategy was the objective. We didn't want to recreate the wheel in terms of conservation directives. We trust the department that has identified the right strategies, if you will, or actions. As part of that, a lot of conversation about the need for funding to address gaps in science and to provide for monitoring so that we knew whether we were doing the right things to prevent problems and to be proactive versus reactive to challenges. We said that the foundation of resource management was adequate funding for the core science and monitoring. And the conversation at that point was that we had a funding proposal that we thought was most viable to move forward, and that was the income tax surcharge. And the conversation was that that best met the evaluation criteria that we put forward, touched the broadest set of the public, the most equitable. I don't know whether we took the other alternatives off the table, but we said that among the ones we were looking at, that seemed to be the most viable.
I think by implication, we were taking off the table everything except the top three that we identified. Mm-hmm.
The one part of the communications we talked about, though, was ultimately we need a single set of messages. We have these two work groups working. We have a variety of objectives we want to accomplish with this funding. We need to make sure that when we are outreaching, whether it's us or the legislature or other parties, that we need to make sure that those messages are clear. And we talked about doing targeted outreach to some of the most influential groups as our priority. Is that an adequate coverage of the conversation?
I think that's where we left it.
Okay.
I missed the first part of the last meeting. I was on the call. So what we're doing is we're going to propose from a workshop perspective what we think would the goals and with the funding needed to go forward to present. And I'm assuming there's a certain amount of scalability to that will be down the line when that hits the reality of what the legislature does, right? I guess, because for me, I see the $47 million. Just put a taxpayer shoes on is what people would see it kind of like, whoa. Given that we're talking about maybe potentially lowering fees for hunters and fishermen too, mm-hmm. And I'm kind of curious what, I guess we're doing a segment of the work of this task force right here, but kind of all in big picture as far as what is the goal for lowering fees? And what is the amount we're thinking that we're perceivably going to bring in from the surcharge percent? I mean, those kind of aspects and kind of give perspective would be kind of nice if people got that far, or is there not yet? Okay, that's.
No, I think those are good questions. With this as a foundation, I think part of the conversation we need to have is, with these funding sources we're looking at, what can we expect to generate?
Right.
And does it then allow us to meet all these objectives, or do we need to scale the objectives, or vice versa?
Okay.
So how do we make this match between the funding sources we might have and what we want to accomplish? I think that's the hard question.
Sure.
And open to thoughts about how.
Well, the nice part about the income tax surcharge is you can set that figure at whatever number you want, and the reality is we don't get to do that.
No.
So we can say whatever we want.
And there's probably some polling from the past as well as in the future around what is the public's willingness to pay, and there's probably a point at which it's hard to go above.
Well, people say things.
I think that if I were going to characterize what we decided, basically we decided the full meal deal, the best program we could characterize for conservation design as a whole, and I'm starting to use that word conservation design, as the campaign we're going to be talking about is something like $76 million biennium. The core of it is the base science work starts out with about $47 million. Then we've got some messaging, we've got some deferred maintenance, we've got some reaching out to underserved groups, and we're probably going to add some stuff on top of a core site. We're, you know, taking some of the pressure off hunting and fishing groups, like basically deferring $6 to $8 million over the next fee increase, will be part of the package. And you can see how that kind of
right.
tears up
yeah.
in this document. Then what we said is, you know, we've got a choice. We got a choice of basically characterizing this and saying, here's what the price tag would be. It'd be something like $25 surcharge per taxpayer if you recognize that we're probably means tested and let some of the low income people off the hook and maybe consequently hit the higher income people just a little
sure.
bit more. But you'll probably graduate in some way, but say cost something like $25 per taxpayer to fund the full meal deal. Now the strategic question for this work group is, my understanding is, do we want to lead out with the full meal deal package presentation, or do we want to start downsizing it in our own thought, kind of second guessing what the political realities are? That's one thing. And the second thing is, how do you characterize this?
Right.
Now, how do we develop a message that says, Oregon, what's the implications if we don't have full implementation of conservation design? We're going to continue to have the kind of acceleration, the kind of problems we've had already, and it'll get worse. What's the implications of that for our business environment, for Oregon's livability? And the second part of it is, how do we craft our messages for our supporters? How do we craft our message for our potential opponents, the no new taxes guys down the legislature? And how do we craft this message for
sure.
average Oregonians? I think that's our challenge here, is to take this general picture and make a couple strategic decisions as we start to think about the communication campaign that will have to go to the legislature, to our partners and our opponents.
Well, from my perspective, I think you don't start downsizing. I think you take it its entirety to it, and then they let the sausage be made later. Otherwise,
and then react.
Otherwise, you start.
Why negotiate
you start
yourself?
Up, you're,
exactly.
You're, yeah.
That's my, I agree completely. That's my
opinion. I think we're kind of running up against the problem that we haven't ever really integrated our thinking with political reality yet. And there are lots of things that can happen that will affect what we're doing here and the selection we make in the top three. One of them is all of these presume a continuation of general fund that's at the current level of $39. I don't think that's realistic. And I think if the general fund gets cut by half or more, these numbers, so we certainly can't start negotiating against ourselves with respect to these numbers.
Exactly.
And because the reality, the external reality is we're probably not looking at a continuation of the general fund current levels. The other thing is that IP 28 is looming over all of this. And if that corporate tax on gross receipts passes, all of a sudden the legislature is in a whole new world, awash in general fund money, and then potentially everything gets off the table in terms of what we're looking at here, except perhaps a dedication of general fund. And so we're in a, I think we have to disregard that currently in terms of our thinking. But at some point, that I don't know whether that's going to pass or not. But whether it does or not affects
yeah.
greatly what we can do.
Yeah, there's a lot of moving parts and a lot of permutations.
yeah.
We don't know yet.
I would agree completely with that, and I think our basic message is: Oregon has a problem, and this is what implementing conservation design would do for us in terms of alleviating that problem down the road. This is why it's a really good idea for Oregon as a whole. Our number one proposal, assuming status quo, is take a crack at this surcharge on income. But there are other ways, you know, the reality is there are other ways which the money might or might not materialize. General fund might or might not disappear. But this is what Oregon needs for its future. To me, that's the commanding argument. And we should not start niggling it down with thoughts about political reality before political reality happens. Let's react to political reality. Let's try to make political reality with a commandingly persuasive argument.
So let me play devil's advocate for a second. So if you had hypothetically. So if you had a $25 income tax, tax income surcharge, that accomplishes X, Y, Z. If you have a $10, maybe it only accomplishes X. I would expect the legislature is going to ask whether we looked at scalability. And how does that affect your recommendations? So don't we almost have to look at this, at the potential funding at various tiers?
I would say you do. I would say we don't. If we only got half the amount of money, we'd only be able to get half of the basic science done and half of the basic communication done, and we wouldn't be able to deal with the food maintenance. We'd have a set of tiering of what would be the most important stuff to stick in there at various big component levels.
Is that the department's probably better to answer that question maybe than I am. I mean, obviously, but we're engaged here, but I mean, obviously, I think they're going to be the go-to body and say, okay, hey, you're only getting this much. What's your plan to do with this money? I would lean on them heavily. Everybody already having some different options here.
It's almost like you tiered up 10 million at a crack and say, at each stage, here's what's in, here's what's out.
I don't know. We have to set some, if we're talking about that particular proposal, don't we have to set some general guidelines about how much progressivity we want in the measure, how many exemptions we want, where the exemptions would apply, and then we could give it to the legislative fiscal, presumably, and have some targets, and they would show us scalability alternatives. And all of that would assume continuation of the general fund.
So have we heard back from best staff on how much would be generated given, we were looking at three options. One was, you know, I think it was $20 across the board. One was $20 in an exemption for low income.
Uh-huh.
And one was an exemption for those who hold hunting and fishing permits. I know that they were researching that for us.
I thought they did the analysis on $10.
$10?
I thought they did the analysis on $10.
Yeah,
that's right.
And but then it's just linear deterministic calculation.
That was just a flat, no exemptions.
Yeah, I don't think we've heard back on the exemptions yet.
I thought we did.
I'm pretty sure we did. They did show the earned income tax credit.
Yeah, in one of the charts there was the on the surcharge, on a flat surcharge, she did have, Christine did run some numbers on those. And then we also asked them based on the last task force discussion or work group discussion to look at that, suggest that a flat percentage, and so they're running some numbers on that too. The 1% surcharge, what does that mean? And that they're just still doing that analysis. We've seen some emails back and forth, but I don't think we have numbers that
I don't think
ready,
we have that.
Really
did that have an exemption for licensees?
They ran different calculations, or running different calculations on it. We just haven't had a chance to sit down and really go through that and figure out what that means, you know, and answer all the questions on that.
And Beth hasn't joined the session.
She was trying to get in. She left me a message and asked if the call had started, so I don't know if she's having some issues.
Okay.
Brad asked about scalability, and then Kurt said this a couple of times at the different task force meetings. What we threw out there was, it can be scaled. And we obviously have given some thought to what does that mean, but you know, we haven't thrown that out yet because the same issue, you don't want to negotiate against yourself. At this stage, but we have the other thought to it.
And is it a scaling back or is it an elimination of actual activity?
A little bit of both. Yeah, in some cases, it makes sense to just not do something. In other cases, you know, cut a number of positions. In some cases, like on the Marine side, you know, it maybe means instead of just going in and whacking out certain positions, you have to figure out what you have to actually have to have a functional team.
So have you all taken this then and looked at, you know, a 25% reduction or a 50% reduction in
We didn't run it in that way. We just went
you know, high, medium, low.
Okay, okay, okay. And did you translate the high, medium, low into dollar amounts?
We may have, I don't recall.
Okay.
You know, we could spend a lot of time and effort trying to narrow that step down. From a practical standpoint, the political reality, the legislature's not going to do anything at a scale that's going to solve the problem. I don't think so. I don't know why we should spend a tremendous amount of time there. It's really about making the case for the need and getting a foundation out there for, at best case, maybe a referral and more likely a future campaign, I think. So if you give them a scaled down version, they're going to give you something scaled down even further, and then they'll say they're done.
Yeah, I agree with that. I also think that what Jim said, this is what Oregon needs for its future. Well, why? I think we have to spend some time answering the why.
It's all about the messaging. Absolutely.
Well, just to make a counterpoint, don't we want the legislature to have to face the reality and say yes or no? And the reality of what we really need and present them with a way to solve it. And if they're not going to solve it, they have to vote. And presumably they would come to vote. That's what's all. And then we can start laying alternatives that avoid negotiating with ourselves. I agree with Bruce. I don't think the legislature is going to solve it, but I'd like to have them say no and hear why they say no. Because I think that will influence the kind of campaign that becomes necessary and the message that becomes necessary. I think we should start developing the message. I agree completely. But that will be modified by whatever happens in the legislature.
So do we have general consensus then that we go in with, we're proposing a package that implements the conservation strategy at this level? It looks like this. And that's our proposal. And if the legislature says, well, did you look at the scaled back version? No, this is our proposal. This is what you need to do. Is that?
Yes.
Okay. And I think the answer is yes, you can scale it down, but you don't solve the problem.
Right. I think there are some other strategies possibly in the legislature, too. And I know, I think I talked to Adam maybe a little bit about it. I talked to Representative Helm. You know, one, depending on what happens with Elliot in that process, there's a lot of interest in maintaining the Elliot for conservation, timber production, public access. And if that flames out in the current process, and they can add $5 million or $10 million revenue, and that's essentially take whatever this task force recommends and increase it by some increments, generate additional $5 to $10 million per year, you could use that to capitalize purchase of the Elliott. So there are some, you know, that would be very, I mean, I think for a lot of legislators that would be a very attractive thing. So
that goes back to what we talked about in, I think, our first meeting, in your presentation, first meeting about the common problem among natural resource agencies and natural resource funding in the state. And we present an alternative that's flexible enough.
Yeah.
That
they could address some other issues that are out there and burning that bring some other people into the fold, some other interests.
Yeah, so we
I
have to
say, I guess I'm an optimist always kind of about that.
Yeah, I'm the opposite. But
that's how we got you.
They're older.
Yeah, there are others. I know some that will come to the fore during the session. Next session are going to be Department of Forestry-related recreation and engagement around education and recreation on state forest lands, not the Elliott, but Board of Forestry lands. And the department board convened a wildfire work group, so wildfire costs are going to be another piece of this. And our job is to focus on the bill and the task at hand, but there are these other pieces that are going to be
in the forestry analysis, looking at the lottery, basically.
Yeah. Yeah,
about that or not.
So could you articulate that again, what the strategy would be?
Well, I just think if there may be an opportunity to bring some other issues into the fold, solving some other problems. And I use the Elliott as one example. It's one, if the current process flames out and the Elliott is going to go on the auction block to the highest bidder, I think there might be some additional support for this initiative that could be gained by.
If you sweetened up the deal with some kind of a solution to the Elliott. So the Elliott solution might be a $5 million a year
to capitalize
add on to this, is what you're saying, right?
Yeah.
And then it's all of a sudden.
And there may be some other sausage making that happens.
Exactly. I mean, it's,
but to me, we should know that can happen when you get into the political process. Our job is to fully and adequately justify why conservation design is going to solve a big problem for Oregon. And our job is to start the campaign. If we just take this little package of legislature standing alone as it is right now, it has a zero chance. But you take the legislature with the 10 most influential business groups saying this is important to the business environment of Oregon's future, and by the way, here's local government saying this is important for us to be able to do land use planning and avoid Endangered Species Act and head off big problems.
Yeah.
You know. And Water Watch comes in and says, oh, and by the way, this is part of getting ready for a big change in water availability in Oregon. And suddenly, this isn't just, you know, about tinkering around with spotted owls. This is about getting ready for Oregon's future. So I think we need to make it really hard for the legislature to do what their natural interest would be to do. And we need to know that if the legislature does what we kind of expect, which is tear it all up and give us 20% of what's needed, our campaign immediately shifts gears.
Yeah.
And all of our campaign supporters are pissed off and shift gears, and then we start raising money for the second tier of the campaign. But you know, to just kind of lay this out and pack and drop it on the legislature and say, hey, what do you think? Without that support base, we got zero chance.
Yeah. I think it's important to remember too, this is a legislative task force. We didn't just call you guys together on an ad hoc basis and say, come help us with this issue. They actually passed the bill, and I think it was pretty close to unanimous.
Yep.
Saying, yeah, we want to identify
right.
some solutions.
I think that's part of the lead message.
It is. We're bringing them something, Jim, that they asked for.
Right.
Not because.
But the reality is we better have a hell of a support team or they'll ask us to go back and see.
You're absolutely right.
So on mechanics, too, can I ask?
Yeah.
I don't know if it has to be decided today, but at some point in the process, the mechanism needs to be clarified as to whether the task force is asking for legislature to take an up or down vote on a proposed new funding source, whether we land on the income tax surcharge or something else or a combination, or whether it's a referral to the ballot, because we have placeholders both. The department level and then the governor's office level, but those placeholders can only wait so long. We've got deadlines of today for more information on the placeholders, and we're working with Legislative Council to make sure that they know the task force is still meeting. We don't have a final recommendation yet, and those placeholders will be kept alive. But all
are you talking about placeholders in the budget or placeholders?
Placeholders in a bill
legislative
So we'll need to know ultimately how to amend a placeholder and have legislative council write a bill on what this looks like, whether it's a straight up and down vote or whether it's a vote on a referral. And so some kind of feedback ultimately on that is gonna be, I think, needed for us, whether it's the agency's LC or the governor's legislative council or a legislative concept that could bring in broader things too.
Wouldn't that be a part of the negotiation as this moves through the session? Because we know it's not gonna, what comes out at the end of the session isn't gonna be the same as what, likely isn't gonna be the same as what goes in. So you ask for your preferred alternative, which would be legislature package, up or down vote, and then in the negotiations that occur to finally get something through, then maybe the fallback is, okay, the second step is to refer. Okay. I mean, ask for what you ideally want, and then settle for.
Yeah, I think that's part of the strategic conversation that we could get the have what's grounded and giving some feedback on it.
And then people know as it moves through, if they have to shift their discussions with legislators and others, it's like, okay, it's not going this way, here's the alternative.
Well, I'd like to hear our legislative members' comments on whether 3/5 is possible. I can't imagine that it is, but you're looking at a referral in all likelihood.
Probably depends on what happens in November.
Yeah. And so that's another reason why we might not be able to resolve it today. But
so, when we report to the legislative committees, we offer them a funding proposal. Don't the committees kind of then steer it to whether there's going to be a vote or a referral?
They will steer it to whether there's going to be a hearing at all, and they'll steer it to whether there's going to be a vote at all at the committee level. Whether it's a referendum or a bill for an up or down vote, that would have to be done in work with whoever the bill sponsor is.
Yeah, I don't think they'll never be a vote unless they know they have the votes to pass.
Yeah.
Leadership won't have to go forward for it to fail.
But you think we need to make a recommendation on that course of action?
I think the report should speak to, I mean, if it's the strategy that Roger articulated, lay it out and say, this is what we're proposing. And I don't know, I don't know what the whole task force thinks. If we should, the report could say, this could also take the form of a ballot referral, or whether it's better to just stay silent on that in the report, and then those who have ledge concepts, or who could have ledge concepts, such as committee chairs or individual legislators, they all know that. We all know that in the back of our heads. I don't know what other, curious what others.
In this, well, here's what I think. In the same way we don't want to negotiate ourselves in already coming in with, oh, and here's the pared down version, we ought to go for plan A. We asked the legislature to give you our proposal. This is the size of the problem. This is our proposed solution. Pass it. If they don't want to pass it, if our campaign says pass it, they're going to look at the political realities, and if they come up with plan B, a referral or something else, fine, but I don't think we should leave with that. I think we should give a nice, strong presentation about why implementing conservation design is good for Oregon's future, and here's a campaign that agrees with us and force them to make a tough decision. Do not go in there giving them two ways out, because they'll take it every time. I mean, it's just psychology. They'll take it every time. And they're bright enough to know what the alternatives are. We don't need to present the alternatives to them. We need to present our recommendation. We need to believe in that recommendation, and we need to have a full-fledged campaign making it politically tough to do anything other than that recommendation. That's my thought.
So one thing we've been thinking about at staff level is, briefly with Jim about it, is tiered recommendations to the legislature. That we go in September and say, here's our proposal. We haven't really vetted it. We want to hear what your questions are. We can respond to it before we put a ribbon around this. And your reaction. And then we reconvene after mid-September and modify or expand our proposal and go vet it. And then report that back in a second tier recommendation by the end of the year.
Is the purpose for them to feel like there's buy-in then? What's the purpose of going in for the first tier?
To meet the charge we have to get a recommendation in by mid-September.
Okay, so it's a timing issue.
Yeah, it's a timing issue, and it being a challenge, and we only have 2 months, and it's summer. So the challenge of being able to do a full vetting program between now and then. Now, we can certainly do some targeted vetting, mm-hmm. conversation with the full task force about that. What's that look like, what the message is, who's doing it. And we're going to propose we have that at the meeting at the end of this month. But we're thinking that how we have some other tasks given to us, you know, leveraging, look at programmatic changes, assessing the effects on underserved populations. Now, we question our ability to fully flush that out between now and mid-September. And we were anticipating we'd be going in and saying, here's our recommendation, we want to do some more work on it. And we want to test it.
I think one of the, and I think one of the potential outcomes from the September reports are that this can be a committee bill. That either Senator Witt or Senator Edwards, not Senator Vincent, Senator Edwards' committee, or Representative Witt's committee will say, committee members, that we've asked them for recommendation, they may have made a recommendation, I'm looking for your support to introduce this as a committee bill. And then, frankly, to me, politically, it's even better because it's a committee bill.
Unless it's a committee bill that does 20% of it.
Yeah.
Then it's not better.
No. I guess you never know what committee bill would say.
Well, let me just say,
committee chairs don't have the same deadlines. They can introduce bills far after deadlines as committee bills.
Okay, so it's a timing issue for legislation.
I really agree with Kurt, and that's why I continue to argue for doing some vetting with key political partners before the 16th of September, because what's going to happen in that committee is they're going to look at this and say, this is like an $80 million biennium light here. Holy crap, I don't know about this idea. And the first thing that's going to happen is those politically savvy committee members are going to go to key players.
Oh, they'll be getting the text.
What do you guys at AOI think about this? Yeah. We got some other stuff going on in this world. And if they say, what the hell is it? We have no idea. Is this like a retirement program for ODFW? I mean, it's going to be the committee bill that comes out then. It ain't going to look very good. And then we're going to say, well, no, we don't agree with that. We don't have that in mind. And you set the wrong tone. What you want to do is, when that happens, when that dynamic happens, you want to have your best partners already saying, this is a big problem-solving effort for Oregon. Don't go slicing it all up in a committee bill and put us in a negative mode right after that. That's why I want to make sure we don't put our vetting off until after that presentation, because something's going to happen politically we're not going to like, and it's going to happen damn quick, and then we're fighting defense all the way to the legislature. I would love for it to be a very positive committee bill. We got to make that political reality happen and anticipate what kind of dynamic is going to happen on September 17th, the day after the presentation goes on. It's a whole bunch of people going to do a quick political gut check to whether this thing is really at all politically realistic or not. If we haven't done some vetting, we don't have a bunch of key influencers lined up saying, yes, this is important. We can talk about details, but this needs to be alive and well and moving forward in the planning process. I just don't want, just anticipate how that's going to work.
You know, I think we need to have a report on September 16th just because the statute says that and there's an expectation of that. But I don't think it's going to be the final report. And I do think some of the vetting will have to happen after that. I don't disagree that we should do as much as we can beforehand, but I think there will be elements of the vetting process and also elements of the program itself that still need to be flushed out after September 16th, and we probably will have to keep this task force going for a while to.
It's lifetime service.
This is like the committee choked up. But you know, you'll have that conversation back and forth between the governor's office and the legislature, and we'll be feeling out, we'll be reacting to ideas. I anticipate that. Give and take, we'll take all the way to January. So it'll be even afterwards.
Sometimes we use the terms vetting versus testing. In vetting, we think about key supporters, stakeholders that you want to move a concept forward on. Testing is where we go out and check with the general public, the larger world, you know, would they ever support income tax surcharge? And,
well, testing is really going to involve polling at some point. We're not going to be doing that.
No. But we may have an opportunity to do it post September.
Yeah. But that involves pulling together a coalition, finding a funder for, for the polling, and that's not going to happen until we have developed our proposal a little more definitively than we have yet.
The original bill, the task force bill, came through Representative Witt's committee.
Yeah.
Had bipartisan unanimous support. So, I think there's a chance we can get something.
Do we have any?
Beth hasn't responded to me, and I haven't heard from Mike.
Okay. I'm going to turn this off then, because we're just in current cost. And we can.
Unless somebody might jump on.
Yeah, then we can probably. Well, the only person we're missing is Mike Rubel. He was going to join us first thing, so.
You could always call your office and then you could.
We just do a quick gut check and see. There's several task force members that haven't said much. Do you guys agree with what we said so far?
No, it's very much because it keeps down and it sits on hold.
Well, we're required to present a report, not legislation, right?
So,
I think that's trying to hope and make some findings and a recommendation on the funding source and what it goes for. We don't have to go all the way around. Yeah, I mean, that's the next steps we need to be taking, as you're saying. After that, let's figure out, are we looking for a constitutional dedication? Are we depending on the legislature to just do it?
But you would agree that we should present a report outlining the formula bill?
Yep.
And you would agree that we should represent a report, present a report recommending that the legislature passes?
Yeah.
I agree, and I think you need to have in your pocket the people that are going to support it from a partnership level, too. As best you can between now and then.
Say that again,
Rob. I agree with exactly what Jim said. I also think we need to identify those 10 key partners or whatever number it is that we want to do the outreach to prior to the September meeting and get a plan in place to do that.
So get some support in line, it's in line by then. That would be politically smart from my perspective.
And there will be input that you'll get as part of that vetting process that could change course somewhat.
What it might take to get their support.
Yeah.
You know, what you're going to hear from a lot of influential people is, you know, we turn out like Greene. If you came out against this other initiative, or you did some other thing, or you threw outdoor school in the mix, or, you know, I mean, you know how sausage gets made.
Yeah.
And so what you want to know is what it would take to get 10 lights green. Because 10 lights green would be very influential with their business owners.
Mm-hmm. Well, there are a lot of things we need in order to even make a presentation to somebody who's a potential partner, and we are kind of, we're still pretty amorphous about any aspects of that presentation. One thing we need to present is, what is the need? We need to be able to, we need to have clearly articulated statement of need that is persuasive and isn't cumbersome. And we also need
welcome to roll call business conferencing.
Sorry about this.
For help at any time, press *0 or call 1-800-500-7045. Please enter your PIN code followed by the pound key. Please hold while I confirm your passcode. Thank you. Your passcode is confirmed. Please enter your billing code number followed by the pound or hash key. Please wait for the tone, then say your name and press the pound or hash key.
Jim Owens.
When you hear the tone, you will be the first person to join the meeting. The line will be silent until another person joins.
Well, we'll leave it on and let these folks know.
But I was just mid-thought here.
Yeah.
Another thing we need is the messaging component of that, which we talked about a little bit, the need for that a little bit in the last meeting. And it's related to the first need, obviously, but then we need the proposal to be refined and have and specific. So what if we're going with this one proposal, our top proposal, exactly what are the elements of that? How does it work? What does it produce? What are the risks, what are the advantages and disadvantages of that? And is it going to be progressive? Is it going to have exemptions? Is it going, and where are those cuts? And with all that, how close does that get to our financial objectives? And so we really need a little more refinement, I think, in all these elements in order to even go have a conversation with Portland Business Alliance or anybody else. People aboard on that?
We should spend our energy on that. I hope that we could, through this work group process in our next task force meeting, get the key strategic decisions along that line ready.
Yeah.
So then we're ready to go start lighting up our green lights.
Well, I got you for 2 more hours today. Let's just say this work today.
We're kind of getting down to what are the key things we need to recommend the full task force and hopefully get agreement with the full task force relatively quick.
Some notes I have, refinement of the proposal, how it works, what to achieve, pluses and minuses, mechanics.
Of the proposal, but also an articulation of the need. And,
and why this solves the need. What's really encompassed? When we say this is the science package, well, what does that really mean?
And what will this accomplish?
Right. How does it stack up against the need? Yeah.
How does it offset the need? Yeah.
And you have to have the kind of 30,000 foot summary view, and then you have to be able to back it up with more details for people who really want to dig into it. That's
and
where the
I think,
comes in.
I think some of us, at least on the task force, think that we don't need to get down in the weeds of exactly which programs are affected and how the department modifies its programs or which programs are modified and exactly how every dollar would be spent. I think categories is where we should be and not line items.
I agree.
So why don't you run with that? What are those categories that we need?
Well, I think we talked about the categories of need in our last meeting. In an overview, it's all about the core functions of the agency in science and monitoring and data production to a level that allows them to make sound decisions and also to fund or to implement that program, that science program. And so that's the broad view. I think we all agreed on that last time. And so to get below that, I don't have a list of specifics.
Well, we did, in the former guidance paper, we laid out the ADD categories of work that the department does. And we had some discussion about, yes, we want that. Recognizing that monitoring was the most underfunded and highest priority.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, science.
So are those the kind of categories we're talking about?
Yeah.
So to a certain extent, we've done that.
Yeah, but I wouldn't go to the, Kurt presented to us midway through our meetings, a prioritization of all the programs of the department. And I went through that a couple of times, and I had no ability to evaluate whether those priorities are appropriate, whether there's some programs in the department's current work agenda that should be axed or reduced or priorities changed. I don't think we should be doing that.
Right. And we agree.
Yeah, group not to do that. Right.
So would it, Roger and I talked about this a little bit, but would it, one of the things we're considering, not wanting to reinvent the wheel when it's not necessary, is the Blue Ribbon panel has produced a number of documents, really nice documents, stating the need nationally. And it wouldn't be that much of a stretch for us to simply take some of their work and make it work in specific.
That's great.
And it's going to consistent with the national effort. We could probably mock something up for you guys, not a final document, but.
A lot of the language talks about, you know, investing to prevent future listings, need to connect people with the outdoors, and we'll see some of those folks next week. We can have a little more discussion with them about whether they've got some material too that we can just simply.
Was there anything that you saw that was relevant to Oregon in the work that you presented?
Or is it's completely relevant.
Yeah.
It just talks about the nation
right.
as opposed to this specific state.
Yeah. Well, that seems like a very good starting point.
Well, and I think the department has quantified the need, and for us to go deeper than that, given that the legislature is, even if we come up with a funding source, the legislature is still going to appropriate it for specific programs. They're going to make those decisions under a set of circumstances that's going to look a little bit different from what it is now. So I think it's enough to talk about the need and the functions that have to be filled and say this is the department's best estimate of what it takes.
But I also think we have to, I've said this last time, maybe a couple times, be prepared when we approach a potential partner to say, who asks, have you tried to find efficiencies or savings in the current budget? Why we haven't done that? We have to say that. And you know, I have my answer, I'm not sure we have a collective answer.
Well, I think we have to have a collective answer. My answer to that question is that's what the whole ways and means process for the last 10 biennium have been about is finding efficiencies by forcing the department to cut programs. And they got all the easy efficiencies done a long time ago. They're cutting meat and bone. You know, that tells me just looking at that ways and means process, cutting meat and bone, cutting meat and bone, cutting meat and bone, tells you there's no low-hanging fat there. I trust that process more than me picking out.
Yeah, I'm not sure it's a question.
Trying to find out, please sell these two vehicles somewhere.
I'm not sure it's a question of fat. I think it's a question of whether some of the political choices involved are feasible or not in terms of orientation of the department. And I don't have an agenda or a perspective, but I think that's what people who do have agendas look at.
Mm-hmm.
Not so much fat. I haven't heard anybody claim that there's fat in the.
Well, see, that's my interpretation of efficiencies. But when I hear people say, well, there's efficiencies there, they must think.
I'm not talking about efficiencies either. I'm talking about there are a lot of people who think that the emphasis on hatcheries is misplaced from a scientific standpoint, and there's a huge political question there as well as a science question. That's not something I think we're prepared to address. We're not set up for that. And so part of my, if I can deal with that if somebody asks that question, but I agree with you in terms of efficiencies.
But let's just take that example. That example has been argued back and forth in terms of budget cut scenarios for 10 biennia. And the answer the legislature came up with is, yes, we force as many efficiencies as we can in the hatchery program. To cut more than that would undercut the business plan of the department. So they made that decision that was the right balance point. I think our answer to those kind of questions is, there's a great big process that's been going on for quite a while, with a lot of expertise to try to find what the key balance point is, for example, between base science and outdoor recreation, and looking at the funding support implications of those balancing decisions. We trust that legislative process and the process internally in the department to react to those questions far more than if we kind of waded into it.
I'm not sure I'd say I trust the legislative process, but I would say that's where the obligation resides.
Well, and I think we could extend the argument by saying the legislature's been doing this for 10 bienniums, and they reached the conclusion in the legislature that they had to double the amount of general fund.
I think we could also say significant fundamental program changes actually are policy issues, such as hatcheries, that beyond the scope of this group. So that the budget that you, the program that is in front of us from the department, we're comfortable with. To start tearing that apart is a policy conversation that you haven't charged us to have.
I have a suggestion.
I just want to add to the hatchery piece. Yeah, closing hatcheries is a very politically sensitive topic, as you might imagine. We closed one, I think it was 4 years ago now. It was a mothball hatchery. Mothball hatchery wasn't even producing any fish. And I'm telling you, I still got the scars from closing a hatchery that wasn't even doing anything. So, not to mention the fact that our, you know, it is part of our business plan. We do. Hatchery fish are a big part of our business model as it relates to the rubo fishing.
I'd be interested in this is Jim's call, but whether anybody else around the room who's not a member of the task force wants to say anything about what we're doing, what we're talking about right now. Not over anybody.
That's fine. Yeah.
With regard to hatcheries?
No, with regard to our overall conversation and where
are we on the right track from your view, or are we missing some key element?
The comment that I had earlier was more around kind of the political environment and fiscal environment of where we are right now. And I think there were a lot of really good comments made about going forward with our best foot, putting one package together that encompasses everything that we feel like is necessary. There are a lot of, like Director Melcher said, there are a lot of moving pieces here where, you know, whether it's IP 28 and other tax measures and asks, the transportation bill is going to be asking for money. There's going to be a lot of asks for money, and in November we'll know where a lot of those fall. So I think until November, we've got to be pretty flexible and maybe have a plan A and a plan B, not one over the other, but you know, different plans in terms of whether major tax measures are passed or not. Because the appetite in Oregon for passing taxes is always low, but if there is a brand new tax passed with IP 28 or something similar, I think that's really going to flavor the environment differently. But I think there are so many moving pieces and moving puzzles. I think moving forward with the best option, I think is really going to be important. If you're asking, I know Senator Whitsitt said this, and he's not running for re-election, so that's, you know, take that how you like. But he did say, ask for everything. Ask for, you know, we don't want to take a tax vote for half of what we need. And I think that's a really important thing to remember, that there are a lot of things happening. None of the legislative members, or very few of them, are going to be as involved as this group, and a lot of folks have been involved. So if we give them a couple packages and a couple options, they don't know the difference between those packages. Mm-hmm. They'll cut back. They'll cut whatever they think off of it, you know, that they think isn't possible. But in order to simplify it, with all these moving pieces, both politically and policy-wise, issue-wise, in the legislature, is going to be a really busy legislative session. I think we need to have a clear, concise ask that our communities can get behind. And it's up to the legislature whether they want to move forward with it. But I think the most important thing is that we have recognition of fiscally where we are, and what that environment is, and we have maybe an option or two on the fiscal path based on what happens in November, but that when the legislature comes around, we have a clear ask and a clear path that we think it can move if it's successful. So that's what I was thinking earlier that I.
Thanks.
And you?
Hold on a second.
Oh, I had a question.
Oh. Any comments at this point?
No, thank you.
Go ahead, Jim.
I was just going to ask Adam. So, Adam, do you expect that the Oregon Conservation Network is going to come on board with and support this task force recommendation? I think I know the answer to that.
But yeah, I mean, obviously, we'll have to see what happens, but I am very confident that the Oregon Conservation Network will be supportive of moving forward on what we're looking at here.
I mean, there's always moving pieces, but yes, I do hold
to that as one of what your early sense was.
Absolutely.
He wasn't going to watch out the room to say yes.
Yeah, well, I think everybody's got skin in the game on this, and people are, you know, putting themselves out there, and I think, you know, everybody's got to take a little bit of a leap here of faith to, you know, we can be supportive, and we need other people to be supportive, you know. It's, if one or two people, groups do it and others don't, then it blows up, and so we really need we need to look at the bigger picture here. And as you mentioned earlier, I think there are some different scenarios with natural resource funding that we need to look at. But those things will come out a little bit later, like with the Elliott. DEQ is also struggling, and that's kind of a little bit of a different puzzle. But there are several agencies right now that are trying to figure out how to move forward in a fiscally sound, intelligent way. And I think everybody would like to solve the problem in a long-term sustainable solution as opposed to more Band-Aids. We've been doing a lot of Band-Aids for a while. I think that everybody would like to take that step forward, but we can't kid ourselves that it's gonna be easy. It's gonna be hard, and we're gonna need a lot of support, not only from the environmental communities, but from the business communities and from other communities as well. So,
Kurt, going back to your idea that we may be able to offer a course of action to address other challenges, such as Elliott. Are we saying this particular funding proposal is scalable such that it might be able to do that for you?
That's all I was saying. That's just an idea. The point I'm trying to get across is there may be ways to bring other, by solving other problems, you bring others into the pool of support. And, I mean, Adam mentions the DEQ situation right now. DEQ, they don't have quite the same field staff presence that we do. We have field staff, of course, across the state. And they would like us to collect their water quality samples for them. And, you know, for us, you know, our staff is committed, but maybe there's other things that can be brought into this that solves these little problems that integrates and just throwing ideas out there, ways to build, to bring other stuff.
Yeah, having even heavy staff doing that involves some assumption that, hey, they're in the field anyway, why can't they just do this? But it's still going to take time and effort and expense.
Isn't that what got you where you are? Driving time.
Yeah, right, taking on all these things.
Right.
Or maybe it's ODFW's volunteer base or something like that. There's probably ways of finding some solutions to problems that get more light screen. I think that's what you're saying, is we should be aware that there's going to be a relationship between what's in the package and how many lights are green.
Exactly.
But we should forward it on the Cadillac proposal and then be prepared to react with people.
So
the reality is, if the lights aren't green, it doesn't matter what we propose, it's done. And we won't get another crack at this for a decade or more. Part will be in really deep trouble if we don't grab the brass ring this time around. We've got to be politically adept as well as scientifically thoughtful.
If I can add just one more thing, I think this is also a really wonderful opportunity to bring groups that can be and have at times been adversarial, in an adversarial role, bring them together to work together. Funding can divide people or it can unite people. And I think that all too often we have these systems in place that create a dynamic where if one group wins, the other group loses. And I think that we've got a lot of folks involved in this conversation, both here for ODFW and also some parallel agencies where there are some of those conflicts. And if we can create some funding structure or funding source that actually works for everybody, that everybody can support together, that does a huge, huge service to the state and to those communities to moving forward on a lot of these issues.
So has this group, and Jim, feel free to facilitate, I don't want to take the agenda sideways, but I'm curious on that point, has this group gotten into the discussion of how the dollars would be advanced? Would this be put into, I know there's a spreadsheet, but what is the connection with partner organizations leveraging money from other sources? I know there's a grants and incentives idea around leveraging, and then some outreach education pieces up here too, and the other work group that we've got under the task force. I know we're thinking about all this as well, you know, what the agency does.
We haven't had a chance to.
What the agency staff does with partners.
We have not had a chance to get into that.
But I think Adam's comment suggests that the opening up the bottle bill is not a very attractive option, just in response to that particular comment. And our first priority, at least we're listing out our first priority, admits the possibility of bringing people together. The bottle bill certainly doesn't.
And that will, we did have that conversation at the first meeting, is, you know, why we were taking this funding source is because this was the one we had the least fight, if you will, right? And was the most equitable and most scalable. So
what other things do we need to do now?
So we'll go back and I want to make sure we're addressing the articulation of needs. So, again, in that first guidance piece, we identify the primary functions that are represented by the 47 million that the department's proposed. And what I heard was that we were comfortable with what the department laid out. We wanted to emphasize basic science and monitoring as if there's a prioritization among these functions, that's the first priority. But we were expressing our comfort with what the department's put in front of us. We weren't going to go through FTE by FTE, program by program, and we were comfortable with the dollar amount as our proposal.
Like at this point, my expectation was we would get into a prioritization discussion about that $47 million and doing the line item. And since that seems to not be the discussion, it seems like where you all are is how do we sell that? And I'm really interested in your answer to that. And our involvement as an agency in helping you develop that. I have a lot of just images in my mind of, you know, leave behinds and things like that, that we can start thinking about what is it that would help task force members when the time is right make those pitches and those calls in selling this package, and taking whether it's highlights or example bits and pieces from this $47 million package and really selling some stories from within that package. And you know, we can help point those kinds of things out, but just, you know, this group kind of thinking about that and thinking about, okay, well, I'm not going to break it down. What is it that you want from this package that's going to help you? And we can start thinking about that. And Kurt kind of talked about that already a little bit, but put a little finer point on it. I don't know whether there's value in talking about that if you're not going to talk.
So, agreed we need to do that, and Kurt volunteered to look at the National Association proposal as help for that. It would be great if at our meeting on the 27th, I know that's a quick turnaround, if department can do some of that work. Can we share it with the group?
I think it should be done within the context of the survey findings, too. Within the context of the survey findings, too, which said no one thinks there's a problem. And so articulating the problem is part of articulating the need statement, I think.
Scott, I thought I wrote down that you were going to take a crack at some messaging strategy stuff here. Did I not write that down?
No, I did. I sent it to Jim, and Jim, you didn't send it out. the.
Can you send me something?
Yeah, it's really the. I mean, I don't know if this is for our group to work on or not, but you know, how do we describe success? What is, and if you have that one statement on how would we describe success of this whole process, what is it? And then you craft a need statement to allow you to get to that success point. And implementation of a comprehensive conservation strategy for the first time in the state's history, I think would be a fairly lofty success statement.
I'll go pull it off and copy it for
you. Yeah, but it's a series of questions that we would ask ourselves to get to, including, it's really based around messaging strategy, and if you've got a group of individuals that have a current belief, and you want them to have a different future belief, then what are you doing? What are you telling them to get to that? How are you persuading them to get to that other belief? And I think that the starting with the Lieberman Task Force material is really, really strong. But just know that the biggest issue we have, it seems to me, is that people don't think there's a problem.
So going back to the Rob identifying three tasks, if you will. One was articulation of needs, and it sounds like we're relatively comfortable with the conversation there. We can extract from that to create a need statement. Second was refinement of the proposal. Let's come back to that in a second. And the third was messaging component. And departments going to help us have something to work with. I'll grab your stuff here in a second. But the refinement of the proposal, I want to stress while we're here today to do some work on that, because if there are questions that we need to ask legislative services, we've got to get those questions to them immediately so that you have them on the 27th. And I think there probably are some questions related to that. So why don't we take a short break, and I'll go pull up the last spreadsheet we received from legislative services on the funding proposals.
Yeah, I could.
I'll pull up your stuff, and I'll make copies of that. And if we can spend some time refining the proposal as a first priority.
You're talking about the funding proposal.
Yeah.
I have some questions on that as well.
So why don't we take 10 minutes?
I'd like to just add to what Rob said before we break. That is, when we finally get around to messaging, I think we need to really listen with our inner ear to what responsive management said to us. It said, a bigger vision is better than a smaller vision, and a positive message, an inspiring message, is better than things are falling apart message. Let's patch it up. So, you know, I think about what's the big news? The big news is we've got a new conservation design that's been updated. I mean, we've got a new plan here that's been updated for climate. It's been updated to really look into Oregon's future. The opportunity is less funded. To me, that's the positive message. That's how we state that, what we back it up with, but that's a positive, inspiring message. The message the department's falling apart because Congress can't carry the load anymore is the reality, but it's not an inspiring message. So as we'll get into the funding proposal, but let's just think about what the elevator speech is that basically reaches out to business groups or to local governments or to others. You know, the fact that we have a brand new conservation design, but there's a big departure in being able to implement it, we've got success stories like the evaluation we've done at Oregon Cobo and how we've rebuilt them. We've got success stories we can point to, but in every case, we let the problem get too far down the track, and we had to make a hell of an investment in order to get ourselves back on track. We don't want to repeat those examples anymore. We want to be proactively identifying problems and solving them before they get too big. I think that's the inspiring positive message, and how we characterize this, how we label it, what kind of examples, that's going to turn lights green or have them flashing red. Mm-hmm. Yes, let's get into the funding proposal and come back, but let's think about this messaging. It's really going to make the difference.
Well, hopefully we have enough time to do both today. Yeah. Okay, 10 minutes?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I'm going to do that.
Oh, all right.
There's a short one that we can print.
Okay, shoot it to me right now, and I'll print it out at the same time I'm doing the others. And how much coffee is left? I can get more.
It's almost gone.
Okay.
Oh, it's right there.
Kurt Melcher.
Hello, Justin. Thank you for asking. What are these moments?
Well,
how's things?
Good. I think that shrimp fishing has been the worst this year. This is a pretty good trip this year. But just a lot of shrimp around there. That's pretty much six.
Price is good this year.
Came down a little bit, but I just saw that the Newfoundland area 6, the biggest area, dropped 40%. And their price.
Was that an email?
Yeah.
Their price started out like 28 average. The government's
I just checked.
And they're going for a summertime price negotiation.
Yeah, calendar updates.
So their price should go up. That should help us stay high as us and everything. Yeah, firm up your debt. We saw a small shrimp.
There's a lot of ones in process to be.
They just don't, they're not very, you know, 3 to 5. Yeah, they were 4 feet from 450. It's the rural market, they want bigger stuff.
We got a message.
I do have a hard time catching it. Except POP thing. This year's POP, right?
Yes.
All
right. I
will have to go. Maggie's doing a nice job. Good. Really, pretty,
it's pretty bread.
There's no difference whether it's a statutory or a constitutional.
Oh, I mean, Those points that I have for the council, almost all of them.
Makes a statute for.
Yeah, and if it's, my understanding is if it's a constitutional change. That's a statute.
And they can still, they can still be. Oh, okay, that one, okay, yeah. Well, wait till she hits up the rent.
Yeah, had two points. At this point, going down the governor's office, looking at throwing in this, using this as a vehicle.
Right here, it's a important strategy, go.
Well, we want to throw it out.
Find a role, I mean, that's what.
Right, okay.
People recognize and work natural resources for their options. That's one side.
So she, of course, she's not, you know, for she.
Okay.
She must have been on board. Yeah.
Yeah.
Appreciative that we've done anything to avoid that situation for a number of years now.
So the.
And she sees the numbers.
Or stuff, so.
No argument.
American has a conservation. But they should have.
Despite the successes.
She's done a lot.
Who's always done a lot of.
Yeah.
By the point, he's like, yeah, it's natural now that because first,
yeah, she's a little, she brought in this just here. I text her.
Well, probably the, I mean, the key thing is we're going to be finding a source.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The parity on people, the fisheries causing the harm and the break, that not parity. And there needs to be, but that's something we can do later. And then, I'd like to do the same bill.
Yeah. Oh, so I mean, when there was time.
It's not really enforceable, but a lot of.
Has ag have a committee bill that is really.
It's on the list to talk about, and there's.
Yeah, I don't know.
Well, I think this example is the time to. We'll never have a gift.
Yeah.
Because it's not a fee.
I assume we're going to do it later, but we've got a learning example. In fact, I thought I saw, you know, that I can do.
I think they could, maybe, I think it's going to start there, but actually.
80, that's been a six.
Yeah, that's true.
So it's boom.
At 3.2 instead of.
Yeah.
So they could still do it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yep.
So it's, you know.
It wouldn't be that.
Say how we enforce it.
Edwards, for example.
Honestly, I mean, it's kind of the swirl of things and. You could spend forever
so anyway,
trying to figure that, but I think right, you've got to zero
in
what are the limiting factors that we're going to regret. Do we have access to
just
take placeholder with
it? Is what it is.
It's right. The way to move it.
Relating clause.
Comments. I think we can get the conservation community and the sports community on board with this. And having them in agreement will be powerful, but not near as powerful as the business groups.
Yeah,
so I'm trying to think.
But we have to have that. We don't have our own base together.
Right, and for too long we've been having these conversations. Siloed in, and we've been setting up scenarios where one group wins by itself.
Really, it's kind of like the wolf down here.
Yeah.
Or the sea lion down there, or things like that where, you know, we're going to continue to disagree on policy issues. If we don't solve this problem, we're all. Big tens.
And the policy issues can be largely influenced by how the funding is working as well. If you have a pool of funding that helps everybody, everybody's going to be supportive of that. But if you have this versus that, you know, or when you fund this, it takes away from these resources. Then that really, really makes it a challenge. And that's one of the big challenges with the general fund type stuff is, you know, we shouldn't have to compete with schools and with police and fire and infrastructure. But we need that and what we're doing.
Well, the nice thing is, if you look at the Blue Ribbon panel, my CEO that I worked for was on that Blue Ribbon panel, and the person who was chosen to replace me in my job was on that Blue Ribbon panel. They have managed to bridge that gap. So a lot of the campaign development that's happened at the federal Blue Ribbon panel we can learn from that, we can parallel that, you know, we can get those voices all lined up.
Yeah. No matter how much we might say or on one issue or another, we all agree this has got to be fixed, or we have a big problem. They're already kind of in terms of the design of the campaign.
I just think there's so much we can learn.
Just gave me that red folder. Just gave me that red folder.
Yeah.
About how to design the organ.
You know, it's kind of unique right now, anyway, that the feds or the federal side of things will be leading on something like this. Because normally it's the ideas that come up out of the states. So it's kind of interesting to have that.
It's also interesting that of all of the states, as far as I know, we're the only ones.
Also, the panel immediately following on.
We could show the rest of the country.
I guarantee you that in 2 years they'll be 10 of them.
Absolutely.
And so we will have plots of our
own. You know, and that's part of a messaging tool that Oregonians love leading on issues, you know, for good or bad. But we love being different. We love leading on issues. So that can be part of the messaging. We can show the country, we can show all these states how to do it. You know, which I
am. Yeah, I like that. That is an inspiring message.
And they're hard.
And Sometimes you get setbacks.
I can't see the path.
There's no quick response. And this right here, if we, not only is this important to ODFW, and not only is it important to ODFW, but it's important in terms of showing how states can lead. Does nobody else have a blue ribbon task force? How did you do that? What was your campaign like? How did you sort through the task? So we're blazing some path here for how states respond to the blue ribbon panel challenge federally, and how we come up with our receipts. And so it's important, you know, this is a long shot, this is a big reach.
Well, and the nice, from our standpoint, is with the blue ribbon panel, the legislature. We're like right on wheels now, right? So it demonstrates the state's responsibility to leverage the whole It's kind of fortuitous, but you know, some states probably think about
doing today. Are they dealing with any of this?
Well, we're already got it.
A year from now, there'll be 10 blue ribbon panels in the state overall.
But
they're all going to be saying,
what do you guys do?
We need to not tell them, we can't close. But no cigar.
We need to have some lessons learned.
You guys heard from the beginning about Montana. Went through this effort and then they ended up with some ideas, but no recommendations.
I remember when Randy Fisher put together his second century panel. Was supposed to do the same solution because we were celebrating the 100 years of the department. There's been plenty of evidence seen right here.
So I'm going to pass around three things. The first thing is the last matrix on the funding alternatives that we received at the meeting. It's just one page. It's two-sided, one page. The second thing is the email from Rob.
That you read early when it came in.
Sorry. You know what I... It's in our
communication. He said it came.
I put it in the communications file. And then the third thing I'm going to hand around, you already have it in case you want it again, the original guidance that has in it the functions that the department performs, the A through D that we talked about.
Say how much I appreciate you actually giving us hard copies of this. I know a lot of people like to work off their computer. You know, I really like to work off hard copies. I appreciate it. And furthermore, I take these things and I give them back to my discussion group. And when I have the hard copies, it's very, very helpful. So thank you for doing that.
You're welcome.
We're supporting the forestry industry. Right?
Yeah.
We're all in this together.
That's a partnership.
Elliot will be more expensive if we can put more money.
So this is the former guidance, not the latest.
Correct. Okay. So this is the last information we received from Legislative Services on the funding alternatives. And so the second page, which Jill has, so on the second page was the tax return surcharge. And we had asked Legislative Services to look at three options. One is exemption of license holders. The second was license holders and low income. And the third was no exemptions. And this was at the $20 surcharge. So at the task force meeting, there was conversation about
$10.
What happened if you, you know, bump that up? And, straight math.
So,
well, it's not straight math.
Doubling it to $20 is doubles the
linear.
Linear.
If you want, but I had another question, Jim, and that was, is this calculated on a per return or on a per filer? So if you're filing two individuals filing jointly, is there just one? How did they calculate what the $10 equated to?
So they were going to go back and check that, but the initial response was it was based upon a household return.
So if it was per individual,
it would be more.
Not counting dependents, but per filers, it would be more as opposed to per return.
And that was one of the things that we're going to talk to revenue about is how, if one household is filing jointly, how would you separate out a surcharge if you wanted to do by the individual versus by the household? How would that work? And is it practical? So some of those kind of questions still. You know, one easy response is you would double the charge if you're filing jointly.
Well, I think you'd have each individual. I mean, if you file jointly, there's two filers' names on the tax return. Mm-hmm. You can't file a joint return for five people. You can file a joint return for two people. There's dependents. I'm discounting dependents. But for a joint return, two people filing, there would be basically a checkoff box for each filer. Did you purchase it? Well, the first tier is, are you below the threshold, the means test threshold as a household? If you're below the means test threshold, it does not apply. Then, if you're not below the means test threshold, there's a line for each filer. Did you purchase a hunting or fishing license in 2015? Yes. No. For each filer. That's the way I envisioned it working, but I was pretty sure the analysis was just based on the return, which would underestimate the revenue.
That's the way it was calculated on just return. I went back through emails from Beth.
Yeah.
Say that again.
It is calculated per return,
okay.
Not per filing.
So. And there was the conversation about anybody who had moved from California over the last 10 years automatically doubled
their surcharge.
Separate box for him. So, Jim, probably Tom at all.
The strategic questions might be then individual returns or individual filers. The strategic question might be what would the means test look like? Would it be just an exception at the bottom of the income level to let you opt out? Or would it be corrected with a third tier for the higher income levels? They get 1.5 times, you know, they basically correct for the opt-out. So something about means testing is a strategic question. And the third strategic question is, how do you handle the, did you have a hunting or fishing license opt-out? And so we can make each of those three decisions about the package and then say, okay, given that structure, what's it gonna take to create 87 million of buying.
So if
dial it in that way.
Bruce raised an issue, and Kurt commented on it at our last meeting, that if one of the uses of funds is to eliminate the last increase in the license fees, then should we be talking about license holder exemptions at all? And there's a pretty strong argument that we should not. And if they're being, I mean, certainly license holders, it's a broad proposition, license holders are funding conservation generally, and their and the fee increases have been aggressive in Oregon, as they have been everywhere in other states as well, as a matter of necessity. But they really can't be exempt from funding conservation under skins what they get out of the entire process. And habitats are essential to what they are seeking and enjoying. And so I think we should talk about that exemption and decide, are we really going to, I don't know how big an impact that would be to exempt licensees or to remove the exemption, but we should have a policy discussion about that.
Go ahead, Dorian.
Well, we're also talking about potentially lowering those fees, license fees.
So we're talking about the...
Which hand do you put it in? I mean, do you give an exemption and not lower the fees? Or is there a combination of that? Or do you give an exemption where it's maybe only a 50% exemption?
Well, I think what I heard Rob saying was that if the funding package accomplishes a reduction in fees, why would you have an exemption that does the same thing? So you, which direction do you want to hit it in?
Yeah.
Because it's a goal. So do you do it through the funding package as a whole, or do you do it and reduce
the size of the funding? I even started at an earlier stage of the analysis in that I don't think we've ever discussed in the task force why is it so critical to remove that third increase in the scheduled increase over the 6-year period. And I think you mentioned that it's something like a 10% increase, the third increase.
Yeah, I think it's about 10% on the fish side. I think it's actually an even smaller increment than that on the wildlife, on the hunting side. But I'd have to go back and look. It's not, the third step is not a large, it generates about $6 million in revenue.
Right.
Our fee bill, though, Senate Bill 247 did, I mean, it explicitly says that if alternative revenue sources identified, that third step will go away. It's a
legislative intent.
Legislative intent is that in that case.
It'll go away altogether.
That's the intent of the state.
Okay. And just a question before, and then HB 2402 mentions looking at reduction in fees, kind of period, right? Doesn't it also mention that?
Well, I don't remember, Jim, if it has language along those lines or not.
Let me go back in the bill real quick. I'm really looking at this.
Jeff.
Well, I think this is a great conversation to have both in this subgroup and then in the full task force as we evaluate the plus and minuses of each of these strategic decisions, and then they basically just allow the numbers to dial into what the numbers are. From just a policy point of view, I think there's two real good reasons to leave that exemption in. The first real good reason is just a practical reason, because the higher these fees grow, every time we raise fees, the department projects that we lose 10,000 sportsmen. And that's a big deal in terms of just narrowing the base. And we shouldn't be doing that. And I'm here representing the sport fishing industry. We don't like the idea of every fee increase automatically knocks 10,000 sportsmen out of the base. So just from a practical perspective, that's a mistake. But from a policy perspective, sportsmen don't mind paying for conservation, and sportsmen will continue, probably the majority of their fees will pay for conservation as opposed to paying for sportsman services. If we were only proposing that sportsman's fees only pay for sportsman services, they'd be one hell of a lot lower than they are right now. So if sportsmen don't mind paying for conservation, they just can't pay for all of it. So, but our group, our discussion group, came to this task force recommending that one of the criteria should be that we honor and recognize the contributions sportsmen are making. Not only now, but we'll continue to make it in the future. Now, that wasn't accepted as a general work group criteria, but it's certainly one of our proposals there. We think that the message that's sent to all these taxpayers that, yes, they're going to get a chance to pay for conservation, but sportsmen aren't going to get double whacked, which is what the equivalent of to pay for conservation, which is equivalent of what if you eliminated that exemption. Because of that recognition is really, really important, I think, in terms of educating people about the contributions sportsmen are already making. That's why we think this exemption is more important than just avoiding the next little smaller fee increase. This exemption is a big deal in terms of just communicating and honoring the contribution that sportsmen have always made and will continue to make to conservation. That's my argument.
So there's a difference between avoiding the increase, a third tier of the increase, as a one-time event, and having a permanent exemption.
Oh yes, I mean, it's a gigantic difference in terms of the things that we hope will come out of this task force.
Yeah, so you want a permanent exemption.
I want a permanent exemption for sports.
The other argument that, and since Mike Herbal was the one who brought this forward, is not on the phone, but in conversations that I've had with him, he also points out that that exemption could also be an incentive for people to buy a hunting or fishing license.
Oh, I understand. Yeah.
So there is
a recruitment strategy.
Yeah,
it is.
Which also then rolls over into federal funds.
And so the exemption is for people who hold an annual license.
Right.
Nobody less than that.
Not a daily license.
Right. Yeah. I think the exemption's a good idea, and I'm fine, and it's already in the statute about eliminating the third increment of the increase. Just looking at this shorthand spreadsheet here, that raised questions for me are fund shift, improving hunting and fishing, pushing that on to new money, and hatchery stabilization. I would need to know how those relate to the public responsible for the conservation.
So the bill, just looking at it quickly, speaks to ensure, the purposes section, ensures to the greatest extent possible that future fee increases, new fees, or other new revenue streams for the funding of the department are developed and implemented in a manner that ensures individual beneficiaries of department services equitably contribute to the revenues of the department based on services they receive. So, the bill tees up the conversation, but it doesn't direct the outcome of you must achieve reduction in fees over time. The 247, Senate Bill 247 fee bill is a different set of existing direction, though.
So a practical question. So if you exempt it, those who hold licenses, what's that translate out to? Even more money that needs to be generated.
Well, they did the analysis.
Yeah.
It's about $3.7 million is what the exemption costs.
At ten dollars per tax return,
not per filer. Right. So it changed per filer, and it's going to be more than that.
Per year, not per biennium.
Right.
So there's a certain. So the department's budget right now relies license fees for X percent. And if you took that funding source away.
If we had no license revenue.
Right. If you had no license revenue or just daily licenses.
Just daily licenses?
Well, what we said is the only exemption would be for an annual license.
Right.
So that equals a certain amount of, certain percentage of your budget.
I'm not following you, Jay.
So, well, where I'm going is, so we have a target of $47 million, and so are we adding to that if we have an exemption? Does that mean we have to raise more money, or is it covered?
No, it doesn't change that.
Okay.
So can I go back to my question on what is improving hunting and fishing mean, and what hatchery stabilization mean?
Now, what are you looking at, though?
Hunting scenarios. It's like $8 million between the two, 5.5 and 3.
Ah.
those are ones that if we're exempting license holders, it's not clear to me why we would still be fund shifting there.
So on the fund shifts for conservation, our discussion internally was if we were going to, the way to reduce the impact or the meet that Senate Bill 247 requirement was to identify the programs that are currently conservation programs that are broad public benefit, and shift those onto alternative funding. That frees up the license dollars. Mm-hmm. And that first $6 million increment essentially hits Senate Bill 247. And if you shift additional funding, which I think the next level was about $6 million, that then gives you some additional license revenue that could be used to invest in fishing and hunting, reduce fees further, basically frees up money that could be used elsewhere, license dollars that could be used for other hunting and fishing related activities. And that's figured into that little total dollar cost of here.
So it's not specific as to what it's shifting it to?
To an alternative funding source.
Could it be described differently?
But what is it that we're shifting is the question.
Those that are detailed in that spreadsheet.
No, don't send me that.
Yeah, and so that's what I think would be described as that 6 million, and those items that roll up into that 6 million are the things that through the department's analysis have been deemed, these are actually things that are currently being funded with license dollars that are actually benefiting the broader public good, so they should move on to the new funding source.
I think what I hear Bruce asking is, why should we shift any money into improving hunting and fishing?
Isn't that what you're fundamentally asking? Yeah. What justifies that? Is it either good for expanding the license base so it pays back into your income base? Is it something that is crucial in terms of the right policy balance for hunting and fishing versus conservation? I mean, that's what you're asking in a nutshell, right?
Yeah, because somebody else will be asking that question down the line.
I think we may be confusing a couple of issues here. One of them is this transfer of some of the existing conservation work that's being done that's funded by license dollars, which Roger was speaking to, which would then free up license dollars for further pot sweeteners relative to hunting and fishing activities. Okay, that's the one piece. What Bruce is talking about is directly funding through this some basic improvements of hunting and fishing as pot sweeteners, very modest pot sweeteners, to get broad, particularly rural support for those economic engines for this legislation. And that's really a much more subordinate priority, if necessary, in order to get that rural support. Because sometimes conservation on its face doesn't resonate as much with some of those people representing those areas, but pot sweeteners do.
Why don't you give us an example of what a pot sweetener that would be attractive to a rural?
One of them's in that category is additional enforcement.
Another one might be some additional, trout put in a local pond, those sorts of things that resonate directly with the economic activity for the local area. So that's the concept. There's one other thing that I think gets lost in this, and whether you're at the $10 or the $20 for an annual license bracket, in general, you're still hunters and fishers. This gets at Jim's point. Even after all this is done, hunters and fishers are still paying more for conservation than the general public would. Okay, for pure conservation, not hunting and fishing opportunities, well over half of what we do is conservation based.
and it undergirds everything. And so this isn't easy to silo out, but it's not, when this is done, hunters and fishers are only paying for hunting and fishing opportunities. They're still paying more for conservation than this will ever generate. And that may be what you were getting at with that, that dollar game you were doing with Jim. But I think we as an agency need to do a little better job of pulling that math together, but it'll be pretty compelling, the amount going towards conservation activities. We did an assessment with our district biologist, Kurt, I can't remember, and some, many cases it was actually 80%.
Up to 80%.
Of their work was actually doing non-hunting and fishing related activities.
So what's the practical effect of, right now it cost me $150 for my licenses and tags, now it only costs me 20. How's it gonna affect your business?
No, it's still going to cost you 150, but
it won't cost you 170.
Yeah, it won't cost you 170.
Right. No, okay, you're right. You're right.
It costs you 150, but you wouldn't have to pay the 10 or 20.
Yeah.
Okay, that's my point, is that far more of that money is, it, the life hunters and fishers aren't getting out of this and without paying the freight for conservation. They're just not paying at all.
And I get the rationale for all this. I think you can make a good case for it, but I fear that it creates some holes in our argument. In a campaign, I would not want to be saying here, if you believe that that's only $3 or $5, that a small piece of it that we are asking you all to pay to plant fish in a pond down in.
So that was where, I mean, that was when I read through the spreadsheet, I was also wondering, okay, Oregon Hatchery Research Center, if that's going on to a new funding source that's not being paid by hunters and fishers because of the exemption and some of the pet bio stuff. There were a few other things in there where I was like, is that, how do we justify that as broad common good stuff versus stuff that mainly relates to improving the availability of fish for fishing?
I think the answer to that question is it's a judgment call as to how much of sportsman's dollars you allow to actually use sportsman services, as opposed to how many sportsman dollars will continue to be allocated to general conservation. It's a balancing question. From my perspective, pod sweeteners are only really important in this package to the extent that they bring political support to the table.
Exactly.
I don't think we need pod sweeteners to make the hunters and fishermen happy. They would be so damn happy to actually be honored to be exempted from this and to avoid their next fee increase. That'd be a perfectly okay deal with me. If you need some room to get 3 votes in Eastern Oregon because it promotes landowner services or some local kids fishing clinic or something like that, that's where you start basically shifting things around that way. So I don't have any problem drawing a line through a line item that says improving hunting and fishing. I think the heart of this argument is funding conservation design.
And
the things that distract from funding conservation design, in my mind, are potentially dragging down the saleability rather than building it up.
But bear in mind that you're talking about that third piece. The second tier is these transfers, which is still getting at. So those are actually monies that can be reinvested in making fishing and hunting better for monies that are currently being spent on conservation, but not all of it. And so some of those are very appropriate.
Yeah, that's where, and there is basis in the bill for some of this. I mean, the bill does speak to maintaining and enhancing hunting and angling opportunity access and public education as the rec economic and conservation benefits of hunting and angling. So I guess the question is that component of the bill on maintaining and enhancing going to be achieved by freeing up license dollars to do more than they currently are because they're not being tapped to do some of the broad public benefit conservation stuff that they're currently being tapped to do, or to achieve this, is there going to need to be some
But you would not be using this surcharge dollars for that hunting and fishing enhancement. You'd be using it for an explicit conservation purpose, which would free up license dollars.
Well, that's the sense that you're going, but it doesn't, is that, I guess, is that the consensus of everybody around the table? Because it doesn't have to be that way, but.
It's just, we're looking at a very short game version here, I'm sure, but I'm looking at strictly from a political standpoint. I'm great with getting 3 more votes in Eastern Oregon, but not if it costs me 6 in the metro area.
Yeah.
So,
Adam?
Just kind of a fundamental question I think that would help this conversation is the agency trying to keep siloed funding for hunting and fishing versus conservation? Or is the agency moving towards a position where the dollars are more fluid? And I think that's a really important part of this conversation of where this money goes and if there's an exemption. Because there's essentially the exemption is an overlap of funds. And where does that go? I also think that the exemption would be really good politically to get hunters and fishers and those groups on board. But I think we need to think strongly about whether the agency is interested in moving forward in the next decades or years in terms of siloing those dollars. All this money from hunting and fishing licenses goes towards that. All this money from the tax surcharge goes towards conservation. Or are we blending those together? I think that's a really important fundamental question to answer that will help us, help all of you move into the directions that this conversation is going.
Well, I think right now we almost could not get more fluid than we are. I mean, with only a few exceptions, our staff works on conservation, and there's an entire blend of, I mean, they're working on conservation issues with hunting and fishing licenses. The official license funded positions. So we certainly, we can't get much more fluid and integrated than we are. There are a few exceptions where we have specific staff on contracts that are working on specific activities. But as it relates to our license funded positions, general fund funded positions, pretty dang fluid right now. And we're not proposing to compartmentalize that any further.
But it would be bringing in some of the new funding source dollars into
exactly
those positions to make it a blend of.
Well, and we're not arguing for sportsman's fees only to pay for sportsman's services. We're not arguing for that. We understand that the vast majority of the licensed money will still go to conservation, and that's fine.
I do think, though, it's keeping fungibility of license dollars isn't our intent. You know, movement and flexibility, but this new source of revenue needs to be pretty transparent relative to what the investment is providing. And in that, right now, the intent is conservation. And so, depending on where we land on some of these pot sweeteners or other concepts, but the fundamental primary purpose of this is conservation, and so it needs to be transparent in the outcomes of how that investment's playing out, and that's easy to do.
Well, I think your messaging on that is this money is funding conservation, some current programs and some new programs.
Right, but the public's going to want to know that it's not fungible interchangeably with our hatcheries and everything else, and that's easy for us to account.
So I have a practical question about exemptions of any kind. And that's back to the funding goal. So if you have a surcharge of $20 to $22 and you have no exemptions, you can generate about $40 million. If you have exemptions for both license holders and low-income filers, you're only generating $20 million.
Per year.
Per year, yeah.
So a double that for
yeah. So.
Unless you...
So, and our overall target was double that, 85 million is, you know, full implementation of the tiers is 85. So we get close to that with no exemptions. We get halfway there with both of these exemptions.
Well, what do you get if you go to not the tax return filer, but the individuals?
Don't know.
We don't know yet.
I'm guessing it's like 50% more.
So 50%.
That's just be so.
Yeah, that may do it. So that might do it.
I think for us, I mean, scenario, these scenarios were things that we developed, and we have a proposal here that essentially says we're going to take some of this, we propose to take some of this new revenue and backfill current license-funded conservation-related work, which frees up license dollars for first to eliminate the third step in the current fee cycle. I think we all agree on that. And then it frees up license revenue for either additional fee reductions or improving fishing and hunting. And if this group doesn't, you know what, if this group doesn't want to keep that in there, that's fine. I mean, this was our first cut at it. So I guess I'm telling you, I'm not going to fall on my sword if you guys say, let's take those two out and we create the need for $8 million less.
What is your reduction in with the erosion of your base of license holders each year?
So for the last decade, it's actually been stable to modestly improving. And in fact, the 2016 sales, or 2015 sales were up slightly, and 2016 sales are up slightly as well. So, but for us, we're still just saying it's flat.
I think it's very interesting, what you mentioned earlier. It's very interesting to see what kind of, how much an incentive would be to buy a license. I mean, just because I think it, I think that is really unknown. I think it's probably much more applicable or relevant than we're giving it credit for, personally.
Jim, is what you want this recommend this committee to kind of debate this and then kind of show of hands as to what we would recommend to the full task force relative to the structure?
Yeah, I think part of that is, so what are the questions that need to be answered still before we're comfortable? So one of them is, can you implement this on a per individual versus a household basis? And what's that, how does that change the potential revenue? I think that's a fundamental question, frankly, to be answered. We're still looking for legal advice about exemptions. We suspect that there's no problem with the low-income exemption because it's already basically done. And if you're under a certain low-income level, you don't have to file a state return. So that's probably relatively easy to administer. We want to hear from the Department of Revenue whether they feel there's any challenges to administering a license holder exemption. How much more money are they going to want to do that? So
let's assume that it's all legal.
Yeah.
That way you don't hear anything from them that says you can't do this. Yeah. It seems to me what we want to do is just share the arguments back and forth. It's
yeah.
Just been doing, and then just basically show a thumbs that yeah. This work group recommends you keep the exemption or drop it. This group recommends we have the means test and not have a surcharge for higher. A three-step tiering, but just basically after you have the means test, figure out what the individual cost is going to be, either as individuals or as a household, that makes the 87 or the 78 million. But it just seems to me like we ought to just go one at a time, share any arguments, and then have a show of thumbs here.
And I think articulating the arguments on both sides is going to be important for the full task force.
Right.
You can anticipate there's probably some strong opinions among the members who aren't here.
Sure.
Is the surcharge concept, I can't remember, limited to just either individuals and households, meaning we're not talking about corporate taxes that would fall on business?
Right.
That was what the calculation was done on. It's just personal.
What about the latter? I mean,
it's a different category,
right,
on the list.
Yeah.
Yeah. But just, it's a separate topic.
I know. I know. I know it's all a separate topic, and there's just do a one-trick pony.
Yeah.
Or you think about other ways to do it. So I'm just throwing it out there for the conversation.
I'll give you a reaction. My reaction is, in a perfect world, I would look for some kind of blending of corporate money, business money, and personal money, but this isn't a perfect world. That's such a hot button topic. I think A, it would seriously complicate our overall program to be sellable, and B, it would turn those 10 business group voices that I want green into red. It would be, oh, you guys are going to pile on business on top of this when we already have a back against the wall initiative. Just from a practical politics point of view, I don't think we ought to go there.
Let's knock that one off. So does anybody think we ought to be addressing a surcharge applicable to businesses?
No.
No.
I would propose that we start by saying that we're okay with a surcharge on individuals with exemptions for low income and licensed buyers. And then we can figure out, do we want to be progressive or just sell it as a flat tax fee per head kind of thing? There's pluses and minuses to both of those there.
I vote yes to that proposal.
So that's the starting point. Surcharge on individuals with a low income exemption.
And license.
And license.
Yes. And unless we need to debate those things more, I'm fine with, because I think they're finer points that we need to spend some time on here.
Okay. So everybody's comfortable?
Okay. Yes.
Okay.
I think it's worth going back to Kurt's comment about should this section stay in the funding scenario. Mentioned you were going to fall on your sword for it, and so does it ease the burden? And then I might try and find if it can actually be taken out, or do we have to have everything on here?
This is that you're that roughly
8.5 million.
Yeah,
I would prefer to take it. I'd put pot sweeteners in when you need to sweeten the pot. You know, it's kind of like negotiating against yourself.
So how are you getting the number?
After stabilization and the friendship for improving stabilization.
Yes.
It also gets us down to a rounder number of 80 million.
So the friendship for enforcement you're not touching.
Actually, Jim's using 78 and that is 87. So what is the number we're talking about here? It's 87, right?
What day of the week is this?
It's 76, I think.
Oh, 76. You said 78.
76, not including the grand, which one is it doing about the country?
It's actually 86.
It's 86.
Oh, then, no, this doesn't include the brandy?
No, the
So it's 86.
Okay, 86 is under
I'm looking at the spreadsheet.
So the brandy, you have to remove those two items as long as described. That takes it down to actually 77.
Closer to Jim's number.
Closer to Jim's.
So let's.
Well, I would rather you didn't just write the quick down.
Can we clarify? So, Bruce, you're proposing that we would adjust scenario three downward by eliminating fund shift for SB 247?
No. Now that one is the one that's already in the license legislation.
So the fund shift for improving hunting and fishing.
Yeah,
it's within.
And the hatchery stabilization?
Yeah.
For a reduction of about 10.
It would be, yes.
8.5.
The 18 moves to 10.152971.
So you leave enforcement in, which it's based on the way this was put together, was new program, new effort that's not there right now, versus funding current conservation programs and putting them on alternative funding.
I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
So if you leave that in, that's 3.5 the way this is written, right?
4.1.
And your argument is that weakens our proposal with conservation groups more than it helps our proposal with other people.
I think it could be, but you know, all this stuff comes back to what line item gets what is going to be determined by the legislature some years down the road when the money actually shows up. So we shouldn't spend a lot of time parsing.
So you just might cherry pick this one line item and then.
Yeah, and if you put a different name on that, it probably wouldn't bother me.
Yeah, that's the thing. So this is semantics in the way of what you're calling it.
Yeah, calling it hunting and fishing pot sweetener is probably not really
right. Right. It's just,
but
it's,
it is helpful in us understanding what's actually there. Given that, I'll agree with you.
So we are changing the dollar amount.
So that's
the proposal.
I would support that, yeah.
One argument for keeping the fund shift to, it's called fund shift for improving hunting and fishing. That's simply, you know, using that dollar amount is, that provides some flexibility down the road to potentially deal with fees, unintended, you know, additional expenses down the road. It gives some cushion for the department to manage around some of those issues by pulling more current conservation programs off of license dollars.
What do you think?
I like getting the number down as much as possible.
Let's just have a show of thumbs.
So it's an $8 million reduction. It's 8.572.
Yep.
Yeah. That sounds good.
So we recommend to the task force it come up.
How much was around 8?
8.572 is the reduction.
So what is our new total number for the package look like?
77 million a year. 773.
Is there a better title than improving hunting, fishing and hunting? Or is there another way to say that? Or was that the best?
That was our shorthand way to articulate how that shifting that money off of the current conservation programs, what the intent of using that money would be. I mean, there is probably a better way to describe it. Funding current conservation programs.
That is a much more appealing way to describe it.
Or sustaining current conservation programs, maybe, you know, again. But if your desire is to shrink the total number, then it doesn't make any difference what you do.
There's also an equity frame on all of this that the campaign and estimating and outreach purposes is maybe relevant, not just the conversation that we're having in the whole task force around engagement of diverse or underrepresented communities, but also I think related to the concept of equity and nexus between the payers and the outcomes of the programs.
So you think it's just the way it's described right now? Or?
No, I'm not saying that. I think when we set this all up in the later conversation about how we message this to the public, we could frame it in post, you know, what you were talking about, Roger, around conservation. Also, equity and how the state's approach to all these things is funded.
Can I ask for one more point of consensus, and that is that we're looking at a $20 versus a $10?
I think what we're looking at is whatever the numbers say. And it's probably in the order of $20 per filer.
I thought that was the next part of discussion. Are we talking about a progressively scaled surcharge or a flat fee? And I think, you know, if I was running a ballot measure campaign, there's a part of me that wants to say $10 a pop. That's really simple.
It's a lot easier to understand.
Yeah.
Yeah. On the other hand, I live in the city of Portland where the poorest people pay the same $35 art tax as the wealthiest people, which I think is ridiculous.
But there's an exception for income in the city of Portland.
Yes. Yeah,
okay. It's the same
exception of progressivity in the
right. No progressivity. Right.
The only thing that really will complicate the progressivity besides just the complication from the finance side is that we're offering an exemption. If you buy it right now, if you buy a $32 fishing license, you don't have to pay the $20 or whatever the number is. And if we get into a situation where an individual with a progressive increase, the individual's cost is greater than the cost of a license, mm-hmm. You know, we know most of those people are smart enough to know they're going to go buy a license to avoid paying. Instead of paying issues with the Fish and Wildlife Service as it relates to federal match that will really complicate things, because essentially we're giving them a license.
Yeah.
And then asking for the federal match to go with it.
And that's why I don't know that I'd go for the, you could do the flat $10 that you could have in several classes, $10, $20, $30 or something, rather than the percentage, which I think the fiscal office said you could also do like just a percentage surcharge, by trying to market a 0.001%.
Yeah, I don't think we should do a percentage. It's too complex.
So is there a general consensus that we have a set fee, probably in the neighborhood of 20 that...
On a per filer basis?
Yeah, on an individual basis.
Well, that sounds good to me until we look at what the number would be.
Yeah, you see, right, this is all to it, this is all tentative.
As
this
our
designed
proposal, I like that idea.
This gives legislative services something that they can calculate for us.
But I would ask them to calculate not just 10 and 20, but 25.
Okay.
We'll probably not go above 25.
Not to further complicate it, but I just had something that popped into my head. You might consider it. This is an idea. I don't have a vote, so I'm just throwing out ideas. But it maybe a way to accomplish some of this progressivity would be to say for certain categories you don't qualify for the exemption. So it doesn't matter whether you bought a fishing license or a hunting license.
So what do you mean?
So it means that what we don't mean, what I'm saying is we don't means test fishing licenses. You have to buy a fishing license whether you make zero or you make $2.6 million,
right?
We charge the same $30. Uh-huh. And what I'm saying is if you're in a certain tax bracket, perhaps we should say there is no exemption whether you bought, you're paying that $20 or whatever it is, whether you bought a fishing license or not.
I don't like that.
I don't think you generate much more revenue. There's not that many people that make a whole lot.
It continues to come.
I was just picking the number. I don't know what the real number is.
I don't know what the number is.
And is that gross or net taxable income?
I don't know. That's why I don't like the progressive idea at all, because it makes it much more complicated.
So I prefer the progressive idea as simple as you can get it, which is just if you got a low end means test and everybody else pays the same thing. Yeah, I'm not going to make an argument in the full tent that we ought to have three or four tiers. I'm just going to make an argument that if you're below the line where you don't have to apply for taxes, then you should, then that automatically does it for you. And somebody else might make a different argument. But Jim, to get back, my sense of what we're saying is we like the exemption for hunting and fishing license. We like a lower end means test. And we like $78 million a biennium, and legislative fiscal tell. And we like the idea of individuals having this exemption, not just a household. Given those things we like about structure, tell us what the number's going to be. Is it going to be $27.50 or is it going to be $34.95? That number will tell us whether we think this is sellable or not.
Well,
rather than sending them in and saying, give us the number at $25.
Actually, I think they're going to respond is, no, you tell us what the surcharge is and we'll calculate it for you and you take it from there. We can ask.
How to do that. Give us.
We can ask for
three
that.
Numbers we can interpolate.
Well, yeah.
I assume they can too.
So we're asking a surcharge of 10, a surcharge of 20, and a surcharge of 25 based upon individual returns with exemptions for low-income license holders equals what?
And then we can see what ends up. What probably ends up to
low-income and license holders.
And license holders. Yeah.
Okay, that's fine.
So, So that's what we'll ask for, and we'll make sure we have that for our meeting later this month. Any other questions about the funding source? This particular fund proposal at this time.
On deferred maintenance, has this group talked about that one? This is one where I think as a planning team we've been thinking about it, we talk about it in this work group and the other work group, or just at the whole table. current proposal is 9.6 per diem would come from the new funding source.
And I would be a lot more comfortable with that if I felt there was any real solid basis for the number, but everything I heard from US is not very solid, so.
Well, okay. Thinking about the overall number, the other question I've got, Matt, is how much in terms of the balance between paying for deferred maintenance with a new funding source and existing license dollars, what is the balance? Because it seems like the proposal is to cover all of it with the new funding source, but not license dollars.
That's what's in this proposal, right?
Yeah,
absolutely.
Recognizing that all the names that didn't get deferred is getting paid for because of efficient fees. Whether it's maintenance on a conservation area or aims on a hatchery, so keep that in mind in terms of this equity thing.
Okay, all right. And I know not all of the maintenance that needs to be done as hatcheries, but right. I would argue that for the not all hatchery work is just benefiting those who fish. There's hatcheries in a broader context too, but a lot of it seems to me to be.
Well, here's what I think will actually happen. What will actually happen is we'll see how much money we actually get.
Right.
And then the department's going to go back to the drawing board with help from the legislature and help from all of us in our feedback suggestion kit. We're going to say, here's what we think the real balance ought to be. You know, so to try to nickel and dime it at this point, I think we just need a package in there that covers deferred maintenance. And we'll see how far it goes. And we'll see what the right balance is in license numbers. And it'll be part of our sales pitch. People will try to basically pick this apart and say, why are you using my money for this? But I think we have to try to keep the argument in our discussions and also in our sales pitch at the highest level.
Does any other agency fund deferred maintenance out of property funds?
Certainly. I mean, state parks, but they get the huge lottery.
Okay, so they don't have any deferred maintenance at all?
They've largely caught up, I think. They must still have some, but I think they've, because of the lottery, you know, they've been very well funded over the last 15 years. Forestry, I know, has done some out of operating. They also got some general obligation bonds, which is a path that we're going to pursue in this upcoming session. We've been encouraged by our legislative fiscal officer to pursue general obligation bonds, which are good for us because they're paid out of the general fund, not out of our own revenue.
Right.
So I think it's a mixed bag. It's truly a mixed bag.
Okay, I'd like to use the rest of our time on the messaging, but let me share an assumption for the next time we get together, and that is that we will have input from legislative services on the funding alternative at different levels. We'll then compare that back to the funding scenarios and see whether we have an excess or a gap. Okay, so for the messaging, I gave you a copy of what Rob put together, and it's a great starting point for framing.
I was hoping he was going to answer the question.
Yeah, I was too. That's why I didn't hand it out. I thought it was pretty
interesting. The inevitable strategy. I have a few questions for you guys.
So this is the standard briefing document that we use at our company. And one of the more interesting questions further down, are there any relevant topical cultural trends we can tap into? And I think a lot of companies, brands, et cetera, fail to acknowledge that, and they don't get the power of whatever conversation's happening in society. And certainly with regards to our issue, there's a huge conversation happening right now. So I think that's one area that we can really, I think, benefit from having.
And now you're going to answer the question, right?
Well, certainly it's the need for comprehensiveness when it comes to discussing conservation. It's not a singular tiny issue. It's enormous, and it's on many, many different people's agendas. And then the second to last, who are the communities or content creators that we can engage to share a message? That comes down to how do we pick partners once we get them on board and the light's green, how do we, what kind of information do we give to them to help tell our story for us in that volunteer way, if you will, so.
Would the group be comfortable spending some time on that right now? I mean, Jim, this ties into your pitch earlier. Could we spend a few minutes identifying, you know, a dozen to 20 key communities or content creators that we would want to get as a first level of attack, if you will?
I think that'd be fine. I came with a list of I think about any target organization. Say, like, we're talking about, one of the things I had was the Oregon Caucus of the Outdoor Recreation Industry. Whatever the component of the Outdoor Recreation Industry Association that's Oregon-centric, in a perfect world, I would love to have their light green as official support. And in a perfect world, I would like them to be the ambassadors that then took us to the Associated Oregon Industries, the Oregon Business Council, and a couple other key lights that I'd like to have green. So let's talk just about a generic process for a second. When you think about that as just a classic campaign development strategy, you go to the entity in that sector that's most likely to be amenable to your conversation. You start out by having a couple of key players. We got a couple of key players on our task force who probably know a couple of other key players, perhaps at Nike or elsewhere. We could sit down in a small work group and talk about messaging, talk about key conversations that are going on in that community. If our goal was to have the Oregon Caucus of the Outdoor Recreation Industry be A, in support, and B, our gatekeeper to larger business organizations, how would you start out doing that? You start out with a couple of key conversations. You'd start out talking about some key messages. You'd start out with some examples that would really resonate with them. You'd start out talking about, are there upcoming meetings where these organizations can give some official support, and how does their timing work into our timing if backing down from September 16th is what we're trying to do? And then you say, okay, now we're ready with some kind of draft messaging. How does this look to you? You'd almost have a little work group. Some of us, particularly task force members who are from that community, some of us, some of them, plan a little messaging, plan the timing. Okay, now let's present it to the Oregon Caucus of the Outdoor Recreation Industry. Let's try to get some kind of official approval. Now, let's talk about how they can get us to Associated Oregon Industries, and again, start out that same little process, and you can see that 2 months later, you have Associated Oregon Industries saying, hey, you legislators, we like this idea. Or, this is a non-starter unless you add this in. Or, I don't know, but we don't need to prove anything for 3 more months. You know, I mean, those are the kind of, so here's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking about, you have 5 or 10 key partners, and every one of them, you go through this sequence of conversation, sharpening your pencil about messaging and approvals. Okay, so that's what I have in mind. What do you guys have in mind? We say it really simply, oh, we just need to vet it. I don't think so. I think we need that kind of a process to bring the conservation community on board. I think we need that kind of a process to bring the sportsman community on board, the business community on board, the education association.
So this set of questions, the answers are different depending on the audience.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
This is the consistent set of things we have to be asking ourselves, but the answers for the outdoor industry are going to be very different from the
answers. And it always comes down to people who will help you understand that community. So when you present it, you get a yes. Because if you get a no, the discussion's over. A no is a no. We're getting to yes here. So, you know, Jim, that's why this is I appreciate the opportunity for you to be patient with me. Just stay and listen to this, because this is why I've been arguing we need lead time. We need a bunch of yeses by September 16th. We need really yeses, strong yeses by January 1. But if that committee looks at this proposal on September 16th and says, I don't know, it's a lot of money, you know, we're done. Then That's why I've been arguing for more lead time. So why don't you give me some reaction to that before I give you my list?
Does this make sense to you?
Yeah, I think it does. I think it's a very important point that how you answer the questions, specifically around what is the current belief of that person or that organization, and what do you want their future belief to be? How do you want to persuade them to think differently? Is really
do they see it as a problem for them?
They see a problem, exactly.
Is it worth solving? Is the cost figure of solving the problem more of an impediment than solving the problem?
The question that I would have back to your question is, do we have the time to do all the things you want to do by
I think barely.
Yeah.
That's why I've been arguing over and over in every meeting, let's get started.
So there might be a dual strategy. One is that you have three or four of these primary communities that you hit between now and September. And say, you know, this is who we, when we go to the legislature, this is who we have the ability to talk to, given in the tight time frame you gave us, guys. But here's our strategy for how we outreach to the other communities or expand this to the communities we've talked about. So we do what we can between now and mid-September, but we have to present a strategy of how the larger world gets integrated in the two parts.
Right. And I would agree with Jim. I mean, I think we need to start somewhere, and I would start with the business community. I'd probably start with the subset that is going to have an interest from the outdoor recreation, whatever. I mean, that's a discrete, slightly narrower target there. And if we could go into September with at least the positive reception from there.
Here's another thought on this, and I don't want to reluctant, because I think all the urgency that you're expressing in this is not something that I'd want to turn down, because those who want to act on this, move it forward with urgency, it's great. But I think the legislature is going to look at, we created this task force, asked the governor, told the governor to appoint people to it from diverse backgrounds. Their initial question is probably going to be, were all these people from diverse backgrounds able to get together on some common idea and pull together with consensus amongst the, you know, 17 individual category, you know, interest representers on the table? And if, to the extent you all do, that's going to be an initial, wow, okay, they all, I mean, if you've got just people who represent, each of you represent different businesses, communities of interest, coming and saying, we all got together on this. Even though there's going to be more work to be done in getting the broader public and associations, organizations, businesses on board, I think there's power in the task force that I think needs to be recognized. The other, in terms of first touches, I think if we're asking people to go to an individual income tax surcharge, we need to be talking to, well, I think there are two things that come to mind. Are there's the how we deal with the union community workforce, and how we deal with kind of those who are feeling very disconnected from government or communities of color, and tapping into this cultural trend around frustration with government, who are in turn going to be asking to step up and pay a surcharge. So I think that includes, there are going to be some no tax, no ways, and I think we've got to identify kind of who the, maybe some dead-end assumptions are. Then there are going to be those who we're trying to bring into the tent, who aren't in the tent, who may have values that correspond to all the stuff we're talking about, outreach to, and that's probably, you know, Latino community, communities where demographics are growing.
So you're thinking that just having a united task force is enough as a first step?
In September?
Yeah.
I think the more work that we can do and the people have energy to do before then is good. good and should be done, but I guess I'm expressing, like, let's not freak out if, given that we've got power in the task force and what we're representing at that September date.
See, and with all due respect, I think we'll have our task force. I don't think it'll be enough. I think they're good. Those legislators aren't going to call up the task force members. They're going to call up the head of AOI, the League of Conservation Voters, you know,
and
the union leaders, and they're going to say, what do you think about $87 million to leave the ODFW? And I think if they all say, what the hell is that, we made a big mistake strategically.
You mean when they pick up the phone?
Yes.
Yeah.
This is, if we go the funding mechanism we're talking about, it's so diffuse to the whole, it's not one person or one group is actually paying for it. That there's a certain advantage to that. Our goal is, I guess, in the sense we need to sell them, but the objective is, the money we're spending is money well spent, and there's a value that is good for all Oregonians. Because it's not coming out of their pocketbook, for instance, but they need to buy into the concept of this, that the cost associated with what we're doing, with what we're talking about, the objectives here, there's a cost also for not acting.
Yes.
And it's hidden until it bites you in the ass. And I think that probably the fishing industry is probably one, both sport and rec, is that, you know, we thought we were doing great by only, you know, 70s, 80s, and we weren't overfishing because we're all fishing it, but everybody says okay, until we get down the road and then find out, oops. And now we've dug a hole, and now we got to dig ourselves out over decades. And I think that's the cost that people don't see, because you don't get you until it's too late. And I think if you're managing things properly, you have to have the proper information. The society has rules and regulations, MSA and ESA, that basically say, you know, you should have this in place to manage properly. And until you change that law, that's not going to happen. You need to get ahead of that curve.
That's our message.
Because we're going down the road with a compass about 30 degrees off. It's close. It's just off enough just to get you in trouble if you don't. We're not paying attention up and you're not getting doing things right.
So, assuming that the task force as a whole is relatively comfortable with this funding proposal, and at the end of the meeting at the end of this month, and what I propose is that we have at least four communities represented on the task force. We have the outdoor recreation industry, we have the conservation community, we have the underserved community, and we have the sportsman community. I would ask those representatives on the task force to do at least a soft touch with their universe of organizations. We can, you know, as staff, we can provide the talking points and help with that. But you're going to open the doors. We're not. We're staff. We're not able to open those doors. And I think there's two purposes. One is inform. This is where we're going with this. And the second purpose, you know, are there any fatal flaws with this? And that has to be done in the month of August, basically. We can't wait until mid-September. And it becomes part of our sharing with the legislature is we've done a soft touch, and here's what we've heard. But it creates a burden on you all to.
I had exactly the same thing. Out of the about 15 actual organizations that our group wanted to bring, there's about five communities. You mentioned four of them. The other one's labor. Well, we had labor, we had the conservation community, we had the sportsman's community, we had the business community. And we think that those are the really big, important ones. So, yes. Mm-hmm. We didn't have the underserved community, but we have task force members. It's not going to hurt to go to the underserved community and find out whether they think this thing is part of their problem or whether they think it's, you know, we're not voting for it unless you quit. You know.
outdoor school or something else in the deal. I don't know what their reaction is. We didn't have that one, but I agree with your approach in general. If we had five launchings of some outreach that went in five directions in August so that we knew what level of support they were willing to say and what level of advice they're willing to give us on any fine-tuning package by September, we would be in a much, much stronger position, I think, when we actually, that would be the ideal, to be able to have that understanding and that potential support by September 16th.
But Jim, just on that note,
go ahead.
On the, because I sat through the discussion with the outreach group last week, Kevin was there as well, and that's the one that Brett facilitated. A lot of discussion about the equity issue, but it's like, you need to do, it, department, you need to do something for equity, but we don't, so when that community gets asked, what do you think on the equity issue? Well, they're going to do something, we don't know what it is. But see, that's, see, I think my concern, my question is you come up, you go to these, have these conversations with folks, and then the follow-up question is, well, how does this address it? And the task force and the group hasn't even really solidified on even a consistent approach on what's going to happen on some of these issues or how some of these concerns are going to be addressed. I'm worried about that a little bit. I hear you about trying to get people engaged early, but I'm a little bit worried about people being all over the map on what the outcome is or what the response is going to be, and how do you then feed that into the final mix.
Right.
Well, I think in order to get where we need to get, to make approaches to these communities after our next task force meeting, we're going to need some written documents that are approved at that meeting by the entire task force that can be taken to the various communities so that we're speaking with a consistent voice on behalf of the task force to all groups. And so I don't know if you're prepared to write that proposal incorporating all the elements of what we talked about today. And we'll still have to incorporate the feedback we get on that fleshes out our proposal a little bit from a financial standpoint.
I kind of see this in several steps. One is meeting at the end of the month, I think it's the 27th or whatever the date is. We're spending most of that day with the two working groups kind of creating something that they can share with the larger task force. The larger task force needs to digest that and say, yeah, we agree, that's what you're proposing, we're bored with that.
Yeah.
Ideally, we walk out of that meeting generally with one mind about what are the fundamentals of the proposal. I think we can propose a program of outreach at that meeting and see whether folks are comfortable and willing to support that. We will not, at that meeting, be able to have those written materials ready because we don't know what they are yet. We won't know it until the end of that day. So there'll be a turnaround period following that meeting before we can actually draft materials for the full group to sign off on.
Well, aren't there some aspects of that we could write by then, such as a statement of need and some general messaging with respect to that statement and the elements of the proposal that has come, that have come out of this task force, at least?
Well, I think we can do that with the two work groups. So we can write a statement of need that reflects what we've heard from you all. The other group kind of have a little different statement of need. They have a little bit different focus. We can meld those two.
The other thing is, your department's going to take a crack at some of the overarching messaging coming from the Blue Ribbon panel adapted to us. So that could feed also into the discussion on the 27th.
I'm just stressing that we're not going to walk out of the meeting with our messaging in hand. We'll walk out with the outline of it that we can then flesh out for you.
I think that'd be fine.
Reaction?
If we can get things boiled down to the group to agree on what those key points are, I don't think we were there on that last
community outreach discussion. Mm-hmm. And so that's going to be tough to, you know, we'll have to get there. If we can do that, then yeah, we can hit that timeline.
Jack, here.
Yeah, I think the 27th is one important thing to do is just making sure that the whole task force is integrating the work of the two work groups, and we've got not just the message from each of the work groups, but a common message that all hangs together.
Okay. We have, sounds like we might be in a position to use less time as a work group and more time as a task force at our next meeting. That's on the 27th.
Yeah. And we'll have a better sense of how much time the other work group needs. They're going to meet again next week. We'll have a better sense after that. Are we comfortable with using Rob's questions as a framework to start putting meat on the bone?
I think they're thought starters as much as anything else. I don't know if they're all appropriate or applicable to what we'll ultimately do, but I think there's also been work done around the initial opportunity statement or problem statement,
yeah.
Whatever was done,
yeah.
6 months, 8 months ago. Let's go back and look at that and see if that still holds as a potential articulation of the problem.
Yeah.
You know, that might be it. That might be the place to go revisit and then take it off from there. But that's really what I, and then the third or fourth last point, you know, igniting a conversation about the problem in a positive way, which is the point Jim made earlier, that's what we learned from the research, was that find a way to talk about this issue that people don't really know about in a positive way so they take action. So that's, I'd be happy if we came out of our next meeting with an approach to do that too. Because that'll drive how we have the conversations with the different decisions.
I share a little discussion that Adam and I had a while ago, and that was that one thing that Oregon is famous for is being product leading. So if basically the message here is we have an outdated conservation design, we have an opportunity to fund it in order to prevent problems down the road and preserve Oregon's livability and business climate. If that's our message, we have the opportunity to be the first state in the nation, except maybe Missouri, to actually show how we're going to home grow this solution. You know, so anything that basically, I really liked what you said when we had that break, you know, anything that basically shows Oregon in the lead,
yeah.
Oregon basically stepping up to get ready for our future, that to me, that's the kind of inspiring message. Now, we got the blueprint, we got the design here. It's really good. Now, let's figure out how to fund it, all of us. Instead of the traditional way we tried to fund this, on the backs of 100 people, let's figure out. You know, so that, to me, that's kind of the tone that I really like that suggestion you made about Oregon in the lead. We're the first blue ribbon panel in the nation to follow on the federal blue ribbon panel. We're stepping up. You know, it's not going to cost that much, and we can show real leadership, and we can avoid a bunch of problems that are going to be business and livability problems down the road. One other community I did forget, and that is the local government community. We need to not. They are very, very influential. The cities and counties say, this solution is important to us. It's really important. We need to not lose track of that.
Okay. I think we made a lot of progress today. Thank you. And we'll do these notes, ship them out, and I think we have a game plan for 27. Thank you.
Could I suggest that maybe have a little kind of quiet side conversation with those task force members who represent the underserved community, kind of do a gut check with them?
Yeah.
I'm wondering if they basically feel right now that we have a package that would be attractive and supportable, or if it needs to be sweetened or something. I think we have a good network happening in the conservation community, sports community, and some of the others. That's the one that I don't have a feel for what their comfort level is or what their suggestions would be.
We've been trying to take a pulse.
Yeah, and I think we've got some. That's where I would suggest when we talk about the blue ribbon panel inside of the federal level, some perceive that as, hey, this is a bunch of white guys making decisions again. So we got to work on that.
Do you perceive it as what?
Another panel of a bunch of white guys making decisions.
Oh, yeah.
So I think there's some criticism of, hey, were we really represented in that federal panel? I think so. I think we got it, and they're represented here at our table, but I think that they have some gut.
Well, let's not forget that one of the underserved communities that could have a lot at stake here is the tribes. And the role, what they say, is going to command some respect.
Yeah.
Some
other things.
Parking reimbursement?
Oh, sure. Yeah.
So what
do we do?
What do you need?
I'm going to give you tickets that you use to get out.
Great.
That's yours. So we're going to.
They do look a lot alike.
Awfully.
I was thinking maybe I was training up. So I was going to let